programme features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Look at this beautiful sunrise that we have for you this morning. And of course, this is Safari Live.
Ready?
Standing by.
You are live. Welcome to an incredible sunrise safari. We just made it out in time to catch the sun coming over the tops of all the various trees in the savannah. Now, it is wonderful to have you all today, and I hope that you're going to be full of questions this morning. Now, of course, you know my voice is very distinctive, and I'd love to introduce myself to you. My name is Taylor, of course, and on camera with me, we've got David. There he is. Now, I'm sure you're wondering what on earth we're going to get up to today. Well, I'm out here, Byron's out here, and of course, Steph is out on bushwalk, which I know is always so exciting. Now, I'm just checking a southern boundary very quickly, but David and I are actually going to go across to Cheetah Plains. So, I suppose we better get on with it then. It's such a beautiful day out here. It's about 70 degrees Fahrenheit this morning. It's lovely and warm. And there's not a cloud in the sky, so be prepared. We're going to have another scorcher of a summer's day, which is wonderful for us because it means hopefully we'll see lots of animals splashing about in the water as the day warms up. Now we're heading on to Triple M to have a quick little look around to see perhaps where Tingana's footprints have gone to. I suspect, though, from the way that he was moving last night, that he could have maybe gone south, but we will double check. We know that these cats like to walk the same paths again, and I think that these big massive roads where there's lots of animal traffic constantly going in and out, I think maybe he could have come along here and possibly marked his territory. So I'm going to look very carefully for his footprints, and of course I'm always looking for the queen's footprints. We haven't been seeing her for quite some time now. I believe that she's just been just south of our traverse on a kill. Let's have a very quick look at this wildebeest. We'll just say good morning. There's a couple of them just around the corner. So I'm bumping around in all the corrugations that we tend to find on these main roads. Now, which wildebeest is going to say hello? Let's see. Hello, wildebeest, who is hanging around behind the tree. Well, it seems as though this wildebeest doesn't want to be seen this morning. Perhaps we'll find Norman the Gnu on Cheetah Plains. But without further ado, let's go back across to Byron and say good morning to him.
Good morning. I'll be Byron if you want to tell her. It's okay. Good morning to you, everybody. And I hope wherever you are, you're having a good morning. We're having a beautiful morning here so far. It's hot. I mean, it's 5:30 in the morning here where we are, and it's already 60, almost 65, 67 degrees Fahrenheit. It's almost a full summer's day here already, and the sun hasn't even really come up yet. But nevertheless, we are out here and looking forward to a morning full of fun. I must be honest with you, some of these mornings here, you wake up with a sense of expectation, like something's going to happen, you're going to find something today. It's just quite exciting, I must be honest with you. I'm Steph Vinterboer, and on camera today is VM making his appearance. Like right off the bat, right at the base of the sicklebush tree, we've got a fresh excavation. And when we came close to the excavation, that oval hole is very typical of a scorpion's burrow. But there's a leg or something that is in the entrance of this burrow. And when we had a closer look at it, it's actually an appendage from a solifuge. That is a spider, a type of arachnid. It's not a spider that we find over here. Solifuge. Have a look at those hairs on that thing. This is one of the bigger ones that we find here. They're nocturnal. And we don't quite know. Solifuges do eat scorpions. They will dig them out. They also dig their own burrows. And it's difficult for me to say, did the scorpion catch the solifuge, or did the solifuge catch the scorpion and shed one of its legs in the attempt? You can see it's still quite fresh. There it can bend still without too much hassle. And you can see it's not a baboon spider or a tarantula because the hair extends right to the end of the appendage. Baboon spiders, the first two segments are bald and don't have any hair on it. But just have a look at that. Isn't that just amazing? Covered with those sensory hairs, that's how these spiders see the world around them, is with these hairs. And lost one in the attempt, either digging this burrow or the scorpion caught one walking past his burrow and they had a bit of a tussle and the scorpion's pincers nipped off one of their legs. I've seen both scorpions and, oh, there's a fly on the lens. That's what you've got there. That was quite cool. Their flies are out in force today as well. Anyway, Byron's waiting to say good morning to you and I'm sure we're going to find something exciting in the next couple of minutes.
Look at this beautiful sunrise that we've got at the moment. I know that Taylor showed it to you earlier, but we've got a beautiful silhouette of a very graceful animal. Can you all see that? Look at that giraffe hiding over there. Lovely. Nothing like a giraffe silhouette. Good morning, everybody. It's great to have you with us again. My name is Byron. On camera this morning is Brian and the Thumb. I hope you are all as excited about this morning as we are. Lovely start to see this giraffe just feeding and browsing these tall trees close by. And we've got a lovely silhouette of it. Look at that, stretching right up to those top branches. Watch that tongue coming out and stripping the leaves off of the tree. We had one or two requests yesterday of people wanting to see giraffes, so I hope they're all watching again. It's amazing, browsing on that acacia tree. Those very sharp thorns, but the giraffe have incredibly thick lips and quite a hardy tongue. The giraffe and the thorns don't bother them. It's incredible. Wow, look at that. One's trying to break the branch a little bit. What they do is they wrap their tongue around the branch and strip those leaves off. It's a beautiful morning, very warm, and for the first morning in quite a while, it doesn't seem to be overcast. Brian and I were discussing that. It's nice to see the sunrise properly. It's clear, clear skies. And all that means is I think today we're in for a very, very hot day. But how beautiful is that? Really is wonderful. Our plan for this morning is to try and find a leopard. I'd love to see a leopard. I haven't seen one for a few days. Taylor was lucky yesterday. Brian and I are going to search the drainage lines and thicker areas and see if we get any sign of leopard. But while I do that, Taylor's got a beautiful striped animal to show you.
We've got the most amazing herd of zebra. There's actually quite a few of them, but something even more spectacular is have a look at these beautiful kudu bulls who have just emerged from the drainage line. Isn't that lovely how the sun is lighting them up from the back? I really love that sort of golden mane when the sun lights it. It's really, really lovely. Now, I'm so happy to see all the big kudu bulls coming back again as they were missing. For quite some time, we went quite a few days without seeing sun. It's such a beautiful backlighting. I'm even having to take one or two shots too. Look at him. Isn't he impressive with his beautiful set of horns? And the dawn chorus this morning is lovely as well. I think turn your volume up and let's just take a moment just to appreciate the bush today. Now you can see these beautiful boys crossing, about to cross the road. We're just on the junction of Triple M, Gowrie Main now. Isn't that lovely? Look at that light. Of course, with the zebra in the back, it's quite special. Well, there's a big stallion for you, and then look at his tail. Now that is very unfortunate. It's one of the things that I feel sorry for most about animals is when they've lost their fly swatter. We saw yesterday how Tingana, unfortunately, was very much agitated with all the biting flies and various other insects. And you can see the zebra waving his stump around, desperately trying to swat whatever is annoying his hindquarters. It is just beautiful. Sorry, man, it's not very nice. Oh my goodness, what is going on here? It's like Jurassic Park. Can you see this? I'm just seeing this tree. Have a look in here. You might be able to just see the tops of the trees moving around. Can you see how they're jumping? I'm going to roll forward. I suspect that it's a kudu in here that is feeding. That was quite funny. Very much Jurassic Park. Like, oh, you can just see his... Let's see, I think you can just see his rump there. There he is. Look at that camouflage. David, yes. Can we zoom out very slowly and watch how this antelope disappears into the brush? Can you still see him? You can just see his legs. Look at that. Isn't that incredible? How we know he's there, but you can barely see him. But when you go back in again, all of a sudden you can see those colors popping out. And that's again, and I know we talk about it often, but it's so important to have these white stripes on you or the black markings or the different brown markings in order to try and conceal yourself. Now, I think everybody sort of disappeared now off into the thicket, and I think so should we. So let's carry on our adventure, checking the boundary before we head to Cheetah Plains. Now, David, is there anything that you would like to see this morning? Any requests?
Cheetah would be good.
So, David says we should go and, well, he wants to find some cheetah, of course. Okay, right, we've got lots of vehicles coming up ahead. Before we stop for a chat with them, let's go back to Steph on the bushwalk.
It's so rare that we actually find one of these little bushes, and you know, it would have to be in an open area like, you know, this side of quarantine, the western edge of quarantine, where we walk almost every single day, and you walk right past these trees, you don't even notice it. It's pretty little. It's a bush basically. It's a shrub. You can see that it's got a hairy leaf with a serrated leaf margin, and the leaf itself, the hairs on the leaf itself, are quite hard. Let me see if I can rub it up next to my microphone here so that you can hear what it sounds like. Hear that? That funny rasping noise? Now, why I like this tree is called Lipia javanica, and it's a type of aniseed here, and it's just so lovely to roll up and smell in your hands. It's the most unbelievable aniseedy smell that you can imagine. So licorice, aniseed. Now you get two species here. You get this one, the Lipia javanica, that smells like aniseed. And then you get the Lipia natalensis here, which smells a lot like lemons and oranges. That one's a lot rarer than this one is even. Now in some areas, this grows like a weed everywhere, and in wet years, in actual fact, you'll get whole fields of this. But this is one of the trees that took the brunt of the drought this year, and this and one other I know of on Juma at the moment. It's just so nice to see and spend some time with a plant like this when you know that, you know, their rootstock will still be alive, I'm sure. I'm sure once the rain returns, we'll see a lot more of these little trees, but for now they are one of a kind really at Juma. A little bit further south in the Kruger National Park, like I said, fields of this, but right now not much. What can you use it for? It is used as a decongestant, and so you can take it and you can roll up. I know it sounds a bit weird, and I'm not going to do it because there's only a few leaves on this poor plant, but you take up and you roll up a plug of leaves about this big, and then one in each nostril, and you breathe air through this, and it decongests and opens up your sinus cavities. It's the most refreshing feeling. And then of course you can also masking tape it to your armpits as a deodorant if you enjoy the smell of this wafting out from underneath your shirt. Oh, it's just so nice. Anyway, I just want to say good morning to this tree and wish it luck in this growing season. Let's carry on going. Ah, it's a lovely day today, actually. Just very fresh. Good morning, Mia, all the way from Illinois. You just asked me, what time do we wake up in the mornings to get ready for the day? Most of us are awake somewhere between 3:30 and 4 o'clock in the morning, and then the camp starts to roll around and you hear people moving about. But we're almost all out of bed by 4 o'clock in the morning. That's in summer now at the moment, except for VM, who sleeps until 2 minutes before he's supposed to go and drive. He's just shaking his head. That's the way he rolls. Most of us are up at 4 o'clock, Mia, and having coffee at 4:30, between 4:30 and 4:45, and then 5 o'clock, it's bums in seats, as we like to say. So not too bad, I suppose. It's not in summertime, it's a lot easier than in wintertime, Mia, because of course the sun is coming up so early. At the moment the sun is rising here at about 5:30-ish. Maybe a few minutes before, a few minutes after 5:30. And it will rise at its earliest in the middle of December at around about 10 to 5. 5 o'clock, somewhere around there. 10 to 5 or 10 past 5 is when the sun will rise at its earliest. And then it starts to go backwards again and rise later and later every day as it reaches its solstice. So not too bad. That's actually good. Most of us are morning people. Not a lot of us are night owls around here. There's one or two exceptions. But so most of us are tucked up and in bed by 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, somewhere around there. I just can't help but look at these round leaf bloodwoods. These particular trees are farmed by elephant. I'm now convinced that they're farmed by elephant, and that they are a lot larger than what we give them credit for. This is a single tree, and its trunk is what we're seeing here. The elephants farm these small sticks. It's called coppicing. And you'll never find an elephant digging out the roots of these trees. They'll dig around the trees, but they won't dig out the root system, the big root system or the large root system of these trees. And they kick off these small little branches, as you're seeing over there, and they chew off the bark, and then they spit the tree out. They don't eat the leaves, they just eat the sticks, and just the barks on the sticks, just this bark. And you'll see elephants spending hours in thickets of these round leaf teak, grabbing it with their trunk like this, and then kicking it off with their foot, pulling it up, and then chewing the bark off, and then discarding stick after stick after stick. But here at Juma, and especially this year, we've seen the elephant dig just a little bit. As they kick, they scoop a bit of sand, and it creates this bath effect, this dish around these trees, and has just allowed us a nice view in of the life of these things. Anyway, so off of farming elephant and what they do, we're going to send you some Byron, who's got some buffalo for you.
We do indeed have some buffalo, Steph. It looks like a small group. Can't really see. They've all seemed to have moved off already through this thicket. You can just see these buffalo walking through there. And we've been discussing over the last few days how the buffalo haven't been very, very successful. They've been struggling against the lions, and I think mainly because there's very little food. there's still very little food around for the buffalo, so they're not in as good condition as they usually would be. But have a look ahead of us too. Some zebra crossing the road. So as I was saying, the lions at the moment have been very fortunate and very lucky and very successful with hunting buffalo. Isn't this wonderful? Lovely little zebra crossing. So Christina's asked us a question about the Sabi Sands, which is the area that we are situated in, and it's part of the Greater Kruger National Park. And Christine would like to know, let's watch this one crossing the road. Oh, that's beautiful. So Christine would like to know, what research is done towards the animals in the Sabi Sands? So Christine, the Sabi Sands have got researchers coming through occasionally, and also ecologists that live and work in the area that do studies. I think in general, a lot of the research that is done mainly on rare and endangered animals. So I know for a while, years ago, there used to be someone who used to study pangolin in the area. And but I'm not too sure if he's still around. That was quite a few years ago. Just look how quickly those zebra can disappear. Isn't that amazing? There they go. There is research being done on wild dogs. They try and follow the movements of wild dog and study the packs and how many packs they have in the area. There is study on leopards and that too. I know purely, I think, from a research point of view, they want to know how many leopards, the density of leopards, size, average size of males compared to average size of females, that type of research. I think there is bits and pieces of it being done. Us as guides that work at these various lodges in these areas have very little to do with that, actually, because those people are usually employed by the Sabi Sands. So in my experience, and I've been guiding here in the Sabi Sands for 6-7 years, I've never come into contact with that at all, because the experience that or our role is very, very different. We take the people out on the safari and we find the animals and review them and we interpret the bush to the guests. But we don't actually have anything to do with research being done in this area. But the Sabi Sands will have people that do come out and do research. So there is definitely research that gets done. Not just here, all over South Africa or Southern Africa and very many different game reserves. But I'm not exactly sure how much and what exactly is being studied at the moment. People do also rotate. Researchers go and study in different areas. Speaking about rare and endangered animals, Brian and I saw a very rare track this morning. We got a clear aardvark track. And that was amazing because I've never seen aardvark in the Sabi Sands. The only aardvark, I've seen two, technically I've seen two. And the first one we ever saw was being eaten by lions. Lions had killed it one evening. And the second one I ever saw here was being eaten by a leopard. A leopard had caught a young aardvark and actually hoisted it in a tree. But I've never seen them. I know we get them, I've seen their tracks regularly, but never actually seen one. They're very secretive animals. They're mainly nocturnal, which means they only come out at night. And it was very interesting to see that the track, fresh tracks from last night. We could see they were on top of our vehicle tracks, very, very clear. But I'm assuming it's already gone back down into a burrow somewhere. They have an amazing ability to dig holes very, very quickly. And I've been fortunate with guiding in different areas. I've seen a lot of aardvark and seen aardvark activity, especially up in the Kalahari. And the reason for that is I think the terrain and the vegetation and the food that is around there suit the aardvark a lot better. They do feed mainly on termites and ants. And in those areas when it's a lot drier, they've got to move around a lot to look for those termites and those ants. and I've been very fortunate to see aardvark late afternoon, especially in winter, because they're nocturnal. They generally prefer coming out when it is a bit cooler, but in winter in the Kalahari it gets very, very cold, so those animals tend to come out a lot earlier in the afternoons, and they'll feed for a few hours and then return back to the burrows when it gets very, very cold at night. So I have seen aardvark walking around late afternoon around 4 or 5 o'clock. Some zebra tracks along the road here. Trying to check the boundary to see if we've got any sign of leopard crossing into Vuyatelo or Juma. And Sarah has asked us a question about the wildcats in this area. And Sarah would like to know, do we see any other species like serval or caracal? We definitely do see them in the Sabi Sand, Sarah. I unfortunately just have never had luck in seeing a caracal, and I'm so desperately wanting to see one. I have seen serval a few times within this area. What else? African wildcat. We get African wildcat. Looks almost like a house cat. Actually, let me just show you some pictures here quickly, just to show you. I know you have seen some African wildcat on the show before. I'm just having a quick look here. I want to show you a picture of that aardvark. I'm sure some of you might not know exactly what I'm speaking about. Let me just find it. It's so funny paging through a book. All right, yeah. There we go. That's the aardvark. Have a look at that. Isn't that a very strange creature? That long nose or face, long snout. It's got an incredibly long tongue to stick it into holes and pull out termites, feed on termites. Very interesting. Long ears, strange creature. You can actually see it gives you a nice scale on the size at the bottom, if you're wanting to know how big it is compared to a human. James has asked, is there any size difference between a male and female aardvark? James, I think the males will get a little bit bigger, but adults are generally very similar in size, but the males will be slightly bigger. But you won't necessarily be able to tell if it's male or female just by it walking across and saying, well, that's a really big one, that's a male, or smaller, it's a female. It's a bit more difficult. And then these African wildcats. There we go. So these are the other ones that you asked about. Sarah wanted to know about the serval and the caracal. So that's a beautiful serval. Look at those spots on it. I've seen a few of these around, but they're also quite shy and generally nocturnal. And then that's the beautiful caracal, which I've never seen in the wild. So it's one of the animals that's been able to elude me, and just I've just had no luck. But it's good. It just shows you know, you're never going to see everything. You can try your best, but I'm sure hopefully in the future I'll be able to get to see one, and who knows, maybe even on Safari Live. That would be wonderful. And speaking about all these aardvark and feeding on termites, Steph has some termites to show you.
Yes, aardvarks and termites. This is one of the tallest of the termite mounds that we have over here, but it is also the home to an estivating tortoise. Now, I don't know if you remember, we come here quite often, and quite often there's a tortoise in here. It's a hinchback tortoise. We normally only see the back end of the tortoise. And in this particular instance today, the burrow has been sealed up, and quite recently, by termite activity. Now, myself and Herbie have a bet going on. I think that the tortoise has left this particular hole, and the termites have then covered the hole up. Herbie seems to think that the tortoise is inside there and the termites have overnight cemented up his hole. I'm going to open up this hole. I'd love to show you. I don't know, this is the first time we've ever been able to document a sleeping tortoise or an estivating or hibernating tortoise, and I think it's worth seeing exactly how much work has been done here. As you can see, the termites have made a pretty thick covering here. That's all just termite activity and really fresh. As you can see, the mud is... So they didn't just cover up the entrance. That was what I was expecting, or at least what Herbie was expecting. It's actually a full-on repair job of this particular tunnel. I hope our tortoise hasn't died, and because his lack of movement has caused these termites to, and they've literally cemented up this whole hole. That's incredible. Obviously, if this was dry, I'd never be able to get this stick in. This is dry. You can see it's much harder. So no sign of that tortoise just yet. Just this tunnel that he was living in. That's a roundabout where he was. All still just solid concrete. I don't think this tortoise is in here at all. I think the tortoise has left. So when we were here the last time, this tortoise was still here. We could see one of his legs moving. He was still alive. Now I think what's happened is the tortoise has left, and because the tortoise's activity has ceased, the termites have made the most of the opportunity and have repaired the hole or the nest or the den of that particular tortoise. But what's been interesting is twice this year, we found this one and I found another one on walk the other day close to Juma Dam. They were the same hole, and I personally think these tortoises are digging these particular holes. I think the tortoises are digging the holes. This particular tortoise chose a termite mound because the activity of the termites meant that, relatively speaking, this was a warmer den than the environment around it. And I absolutely think that that tortoise is not here anymore. Roger, while I'm busy excavating here, you've asked if I couldn't quite catch the animal you were asking about, but will termites wall off predators or intruders? No, they won't, to be honest with you, Roger. The activity will have to cease, and then the termites will fix the damage. So let's use this as an example. If an animal like myself has now come to excavate here, I'm creating a disturbance that's sending a message through this termite mound. Workers will be approaching, as will soldiers. Generally speaking, because I'm big and I've got this big angry stick and all that sort of stuff, the termites will retreat from me to a point where they can seal off tunnels. And they will seal off tunnels and move in a sort of rearward motion away from the disturbance and wait for the disturbance to leave, and then they will block off on the outside. So there's a lion roaring right here next to it. So you won't be able to hear that, but literally in that direction, maybe 100 yards, 200 yards, there's a big male lion booming his roar out at us, and hijacked my story a little bit. So let me just get myself back on track over here while I think to myself. So While the disturbance is happening, while the ant bear, aardvark, pangolin, whatever is digging into this termite mound, the termites will be blocking off tunnels. As soon as that disturbance leaves, they'll block off the exit tunnel right at the outside. They'll block it off here, and then they will do their repairs on the inside behind a cover. So no, they won't wall off an intruder. If that sort of basically answers your question, a little bit of a roundaway plus a hijack by the lion. So I'm now 100% convinced that this tortoise has left. That was about as deep as what the back end of the tortoise was. And it's just solid concrete. So I'm convinced that the tortoise has left and that the termites have then just gone to repair the damage. And I'm gonna put all their mud back so that we don't, you know, fix our disturbance. I don't want to really dig into the termite, but we needed to find out the answer of that question. Alrighty, we're going to send you over to Taylor. She's got an update. She's finally on Cheetah Plains, and I'm sure she's going to tell you what she wants to do for the morning.
Well, we found something for you, and luckily for us, it can't run away. Now, this involves, of course, me getting out of the vehicle, so let me do so. Let me get untangled. Out we go. I very quickly want to show you what's happening on the side of the road. Look at these amazing nests. Now, there are absolutely... Darby, I don't know if you can maybe have a look over here. Can you see those little beetles, those chafers? It's actually quite interesting. They're covered in ants at the moment, but this is indeed the home of the community nest spiders. Now, there's probably quite a few in here. And typically, these nests are made up of the females and their young, and the odd male or two hanging around in the nest too. But they can house up to about 100 spiders. Can you believe that? But I find it really interesting now that these ants are coming around. And if we go back to over here, and sort of utilizing the parts that are not being utilized by the spiders. So it's almost like there's a bit of a symbiosis going on here. I don't know if it's a coincidence or if it's just ants taking advantage, and they found that with all the beetles and after all the rain, of course, the abundance of insects around. And it's very easy for the insects to get trapped in here. And perhaps there's been so many beetles that there's almost too much food for the spiders. There we go. Providing an opportunity for all the ants. Let's see if we can entice them to come out. I just need to find, we'll go with the leaf today. Normally we like to use grass. Oh my goodness, I'm finding all sorts of things. I found something else that I can show you. Let's see. No, nothing's coming out just yet. Perhaps they are too clever for me and they know that I'm here. Let's try this. Oh no, they're coming. They're coming out. Did you see the one come out there? No, it's most likely a female. The females are larger than the males. Let's see again. No. Okay. Well, I won't disturb them too much, but of course that's a community nest spider. But have a look what else caught my attention. And I'm so glad that I can't focus on one thing for too long. David, you know that you have a couple of spider webs across your lens.
No, I don't.
Can I please remove them for you? David's going to remove the spider webs. They have been all around at the moment. They've covered my aerial, they were on my hat, and of course they got the lens too. But have a look at this. Isn't it beautiful? The larvae caterpillar of something. I wonder if it's perhaps not a moth caterpillar, this one, but I'm uncertain. It's so difficult at the moment with all the different types of insects and things that are coming out and around. And of course, with the butterflies and moth, the larvae are absolutely blooming at the moment with all the leaves that have come through on the trees. But I don't know what this is. Perhaps I'll have to take a photo as well, or even better, maybe you can take a screenshot for me so that I can try and identify who this will eventually turn into. So snap away for me, please, and then you can hashtag Safari Live. You can add it to Twitter, or you can email it to us, questions@wildearth.tv. But let me put little caterpillar back. I can also hear the lions calling. No, Now, it might be a bit far away for all of you to see. It does sound like it's in Torchwood, and I'm not sure who's calling. Sounds like a male, just one. Let me jump back in very quickly. Oh my goodness, I've lost my cable. No, I haven't. I've got it back again. There we go. Now I'm back in. But let's continue a little further. I'm not sure where those lions are, what the pride has been doing. We heard them calling throughout the entire night. Now, I suspect that there's obviously some that have ventured into Torchwood. But, well, we unfortunately can't go and investigate there. But we're going to continue on towards Cheetah Plains. Right. We're going to go...
clearing or whatever. Nothing. So we're trying to work out. We've heard some lions calling in the distance. We've had no sign of any leopard activity, but there are lions calling, so we're going to see if we can find lions this morning. Now, yesterday afternoon, we had an amazing afternoon following the lions, and we saw a number of females from the Unkuhuma pride coming out, walking around, and we had the two males around, but they were all heading in different directions. It was very interesting behavior. We did find another buffalo carcass that two of the lions went to, but didn't actually feed on it. The lioness fed on a little bit, tried to open the buffalo carcass, and then eventually they moved off. So it was very interesting. And then on our way back, we came across another two different females. Firstly, one female, she went and drank at the little Galago pan, the little Galago waterhole. And just as we said goodbye to you, we're about to leave and another lioness came out and she joined and she also went and had a drink. So it's very interesting behavior yesterday. These lions are all over. But we have heard them calling in the distance. So what I'm thinking is maybe we need to go and check that buffalo carcass that we found yesterday. It was in a very dense block, in a very thick area. So I'm hoping I remember more or less where it was. And let's see, maybe those lions are around there and they're feeding on that buffalo. Such an amazing morning. Lovely temperature now. It's not too hot just yet, but clear blue skies. Look at that. Really amazing spring morning. Almost summer. We're getting there. The temperature definitely feels like it's summer. But we're still going to get a lot hotter. So Laura just made a comment and said she thinks we're on about 50 or 51 days of big cat sightings. And Laura, I think if we find these lions today, we're on 51 days. So I'm gonna head straight into that direction where I think the lions have been calling. Sounds like they've been, we could hear them from camp this morning, so they weren't that far from camp. But it sounds like what's happening is possibly the Birmingham males have split up into different areas. And I think there's one that's right up against the Kruger boundary, the Kruger National Park boundary. So beyond our boundary. And he has been calling, and I think these lions are returning that vocalization and returning the call. Lions do that to communicate, let each other know where they are in their territory, and it's also a sign to mark territory and warn other lions that this is their space, this is their territory, those lions should stay away. Look at this, we found some Inyala, everyone. Little group. Oh, look at that. Those are young-ish males with those females. They're not full-grown adults. The males are the darker ones with the horns and those beautiful females. I can actually see. It's interesting. Look at that male. Why I want you to look at him is he's still a very light brown color. He's starting to turn gray. Can you see that? And when they are young, the males are the same color as the females, that reddish brown. And as they start to get older, that color changes and they become that beautiful gray. You can see that one's almost completely gray already. Both male and female have got the white markings down the body, those beautiful white stripes. That's a female through there. But the males, their coat goes a beautiful gray color, and they've got the large horns that spiral slightly. And then also that's very shaggy coat compared to the females, very long hair. Often people ask if they're different species because they look so different. The males look completely different to the females. It's lovely to see these young males with a group of females, and you can see that stage that they go through where they start changing their color. Look at that. That's really interesting. That young one is in the transformation phase, moving into that gray phase, gray coloration. But that was really lovely to see something different. Nice to see a group. Don't see a big male around with them. Often small groups or small herds of antelope like this, the females and the youngsters tend to stay together, and then the males will usually move or occasionally form bachelor herds. They'll move around by themselves or bachelor herds, and they'll move together. Only when they're looking to mate with the females will they join again. Kudu are similar. Kudu do the same. The big males tend to move around together. When they're looking to mate, they'll join up with the females and the rest of the small herd. It's often the case in nature. The males don't necessarily like to stay with the females for too long. Only if they know they're going to get, if it's perhaps food, like lions like to hang around with females if they think they're going to get food. But also mainly because they want to mate with the females. So we're going to continue into that direction, or heading into that direction where I think those lions are. See if we can't find them. While I do that, Steph is still on the walk. Let's see what he's got.
You know, sometimes the passage of an animal, their tracks and the signs that they leave tell such a wonderful story. I'm going to try and explain something to you, and I'd like you to picture in your mind what I'm going to explain to you. So this is a group of elephants that we're trailing coming through the forest. This elephant saw the bush, this bush that's in front of you here, walked over to it because elephants like to eat the bark of this particular tree. And this elephant spent quite a long time breaking off branches with their trunk. You can see that the leaves are still fairly fresh. This is a fairly fresh Combretum kill. And spent some time breaking off some branches and eating the bark and doing its thing. And then the elephant ran out of small twigs. You can see small to medium twigs. The elephant ran out. So it came around to where you're standing now and put the forehead against this particular tree, stood right here, put her forehead or his forehead against this tree and broke it. Big cracking crash down onto the ground. And then in its frustration, because it couldn't obviously get around to leverage this off, this was too hard, you can see, too hard to break off with a trunk or too hard to push with their tusks, got a bit frustrated and stood right here and, like a dog chews a bone, chewed the bark off of this tree at the right height. And this feeding sign here is what we're seeing their molars doing along the tree. So this elephant basically then just fed along the tree, chewing the bark off all the way to the end, and then carried on walking away from the tree. Isn't this just the most delightful story that you can see? I don't know, for me it just is like a pub. It's like a pub that's, you know, you're seeing a bunch of glasses on the took off this, but I think the elephant fed here. The tracks of these elephants are going in this direction. I think the elephant fed here for a long time. Here you can see broke off this branch in a similar fashion, only here there was some termite damage and the branch managed to fall over and they spent some time feeding there. But this one is just at elephant level and then put their mouth on, probably stood here flapping their ears and just gnawed their way along this branch. It's such a delightful story. Shame, and obviously just killing the tree in the process. Now, Christine, you've just asked me a question I love to answer. You've just asked, how often do we find something new and exciting on a walk? Christine, I find something new on a walk almost every day. There's stuff that we look at here that I have absolutely no clue as to what it is, why it's doing that, what type of behavior happens. Pretty much every single day. In actual fact, some days I feel quite overwhelmed with the amount of things that we don't know about the bush and that we don't know about what's going on, and we don't know what this insect is called or what it's doing or what behavior that animal has done. So almost every day here, Christine, and it's been pretty much the hallmark of trails done here over the last couple of years, almost two decades worth. There's always something new to have a look at, always something interesting to see. I mean, this is the first time that I've seen an elephant not bother with the effort needed to break this particular tree and to utilize the height at mouth level and just sort of walk its way along like a dog would gnaw a bone, really. And you know, taken and looked at from a bit of a distance, you can see it's so clear, the sharp edges of the elephant's molars. Excuse me, walking in front of you there. You can see that's a molar, there's a molar, there's a molar, there's a molar, there's a molar. And that's just the ridges. If you take your tongue and run them along your back teeth, take your tongue and run them along your back teeth, you'll notice that your back teeth have those ridges, those double ridges. Especially on the inside of the mouth. Elephant obviously don't have them on the inside, theirs are on the outside. And that is what we've seen. We're seeing this elephant going, and that's the scrape of the molar of their very, very effective tool. All right, now we are moving, unfortunately at the moment, with the wind. So the wind is blowing from us in the direction that we move in. And while it's always a good idea to turn around and walk with the wind into your face, we literally just want to get onto the crest here and go and have a look. There's a giant albizia that is on top of the crest here. And I want to go see if the albizia on top of the sandy patch crest has pushed out some leaves. From there, we'll turn into the wind and we're actually going to walk directly at the sound where that lion's roar came from a bit earlier, just in case Byron can't find it for you. We're going to see if we can walk into it. Right, now we're going to carry on. You're going to go off to Taylor, who's I think by now reached Cheetah Plains and is ready for an update for you.
I'm definitely on Cheetah Plains and I'm so excited because I've just got wind that quarantine male leopard has actually crossed onto Cheetah Plains. Now we're racing around to head to Pipeline Road. We go straight here. Yes, I'm just double checking because Mike is with him trying to keep up with him. Now we know how tricky leopards can be. We see it quite often with Karula, how she loves to move on the drainage lines and through all the thickest of thick vegetation. So we need to give him a helping hand indeed. Right, so I'm going to go a little bit quicker than normal. We're going to only stop for exceptional things because I don't want to lose quarantine. It's another leopard I haven't seen before and I desperately need to get him on my list. Now, my troubles lie in I don't know very much about quarantine. Oh, jackal. This is pretty cool. Well spotted, David. Let's see if we can... Oh, there's two of them. Wait, look. Let's see, the one's going to cross the road. You see it run? There it goes. A side striped jackal. And very, very typical behavior of the jackals to dart away. And unfortunately, when you are down on the bottom of the predator's hierarchy, well, you're a little bit on the sly and secretive side. So, let's see if we can get another view of these side-striped jackals, but I suspect, though, that they could have disappeared down into the drainage. They don't like the big vehicles very much. Sometimes you get lucky and you catch them when they're sleeping under the shade of a tree. But this is one of the things that we're so fortunate to see when we come across two cheetah plains, is these jackal. Now, I'm just having a little scan. There we go, I can see one. I just need to try and find a gap again. Hang on, I think I might get a good one here. A little bit further. Can you see him in there, Darby? Is that fine?
Yeah.
There we go. Look at him. Oh, look at the... Now, we see black-backed jackal, which are not as common up in this area as the side stripe. The side stripe have really taken over in terms of jackal populations, even though they're sort of few and far between. And as it disappears off, I just love their look. They almost look a bit more rugged. Slightly smaller face than the black-backed jackal. And then, of course, their markings are quite different. But it seems as though that's the end of them. Oh, no, there they're running off behind us. Just got to find them. It's not so difficult also, again, blending into the vegetation, so we've got to wait for them to move to sort of figure out where exactly they are behind the trees. Right. Okay, I think those jackal do not want to be followed anymore, so we shall leave them be. But let's continue ahead. And I actually see some zebra. And I know that you are all very excited to see Quarantine. Now, I'd love to find out a little bit more about Quarantine, as to how old he is, if there's any sort of interesting information you perhaps have. Now, I can see a bird. Who are you? And it's flying away now. I didn't get a chance to see who it was. Perhaps it was a Wahlberg's eagle. And I see lots of zebra up ahead, and I think we're coming up to the pans. So let's have a little look at these zebra, and then I'll chat to Mike, and oh no, the zebra are running away. What's wrong, zebbies? Oh no. Well, not oh no, I don't know why I said that. Look at this buffalo. Sorry, I'm going to draw your attention away from the zebra. Look at this buffalo in the mud. Now, it looks like a young buffalo, and unfortunately it looks very thin. I don't think it's stuck in the mud. I think it is able to get out. I can see its front legs, and we can see it moving here. I think that this buffalo is extremely weak and hasn't, unfortunately, had enough sustenance, enough food to eat. Come on, little one. Its legs are not really trapped at all. You can see it kicking there. Now, this is very sad, of course, very, very sad. But this is the circle of life. I think that this buffalo will most likely, unfortunately, pass away in this pan of water. I think that it just has no energy left at all. And in the heat of the day, the only thing that it can do, and sort of its last bit of life, is to try and keep cool. And that's, of course, where these pools of water and the mud come in handy. But I think that this buffalo, if we come back here this afternoon, I don't think it will be around anymore, unfortunately. But as sad as that may be, the vultures will take opportunity. Those jackals we just saw, this will be an amazing opportunity for them to have a good meal. Perhaps they have some pups somewhere that they also need to feed. And of course, I'm sure the hyenas and maybe even the Styx pride will come back to an area like this. But let's continue. Sorry, buffalo. And this is it, though.
David,
is that nature does provide food. Now, I need to just... Oh, well, let me turn the radio down. I'll chat to Mike when everyone's finished. But I just want to also double-check where I am, so I'm going to just quickly look at my GPS, that we're going the right way. Okay, perfect. We've got a little bit longer to go. We've got to make a left. Now, those zebra dashed away. They don't seem to be too happy about approaching the water. A little bit nervous of something. Oh my goodness, and the bones are scattered all over the show here, all those buffalo skulls that are around the pans. But like I said, I'd be very, very excited and happy if you could share some information about Quarantine with me so I can add to my notebook as I start to build up my own profiles of the various leopards of the Sabi Sands. I know the ones down in the south, relatively one, but not the ones up in the north. Thank thank you so much, Ellen, for your information this morning. I've got a roadblock here. The elephants have pulled a marula branch off the tree. Now, Ellen says that quarantine was indeed born in 2012, in December, and apparently his father is Mvula. Okay, that's very interesting. Thanks, Ellen. When we stop, I'll have to add that to my profile on the leopards. Now, I need to very quickly try and get hold of Mike, as I don't want to... I don't know if he's possibly moved. Let's just double-check where we are. No, that's fine. We need to take this road. Let's see if I can get hold of him. There seems to be lots of chatting. No, it doesn't seem like I'm going to be able to get hold of him just yet, but we found some buffalo. Hey, buffalo. Good morning. Now, I wonder if that buffalo that we saw is perhaps not from the same herd, the one that was stuck in the mud. Sorry, everyone's talking lots of interesting things on the radio, and now I can't get hold of Mike, which is not good. Hello, buffalo. Have you perhaps seen a leopard come past here? Yes? No? She looks like she may know. Look at all how grey her face is. Hello, girl. Oh, this is interesting. She's very curious by us. What's wrong? Look at her. She definitely looks like she's got a calf inside of her. Hey, big girl. I hope you get enough food. Oh, lovely. Beautiful herd of buffalo. Not too many of them, just a couple around here. All desperately in search of food. Perhaps a little bit later they will go to those pans and have a little wallow in them. It doesn't look like they've got any fresh mud on them. That's lovely. But I think it's time to leave these buffalo. I really need to try and get hold of Mike and try and figure out where this leopard is and now move to. Right, there's a gap. Mike for Taylor. Right, let's very quickly go back across to Byron while I try and search for quarantine.
So we're in this very thick area that we saw these lions in yesterday, but what is interesting is, and I want to show you this carcass that we found yesterday, it's been completely demolished. I'm just sorry, hang on a second, I just want to scan this drainage line close to us because Steph and them thought that, and we also thought that the lions that we could hear calling were coming from this area. So I thought, let's have a look at this this carcass and see. The lions are definitely here last night. They fed on this buffalo and they basically finished it, which is great because at one stage we thought maybe they're just going to leave it. When that lioness and male moved off, but they definitely, the rest of the pride knew that this buffalo was here and they came back to feed on it. See, it's a little bit tricky to maneuver through here, but have a look. I want to show you this carcass. So Virginia from Kentucky has asked us a question about the Nkuhuma pride. And Virginia would like to know, would the lions and the cubs move to where food is or would they stay in the area? So Virginia, it all depends. You know, at the moment there's been a lot of food and water around. So they're very happy in this area, in this territory. And lions are very territorial. They have got very large territories, but generally lions stick within their territory. They won't move out of it because they'll potentially move into territory of other lions, and that could mean danger because then you'll find that they'll fight for the territory and that could end up in some lions dying. So generally they stay in their territory as much as possible. Have a look at this. So those who joined us last night saw the large carcass we found. It was a whole buffalo. Look at this, completely demolished, nothing left. Just a few flies around there, but when we found it yesterday afternoon, this buffalo was actually just off to the left, and we'll show you the spot now. But look at that, the rib cage, everything's been eaten off of this carcass. If you look just off to the left, you can see there's a very open bare patch. Do you see that? That's where the buffalo was lying yesterday when we found it. And you can see they've fed, and they probably scrapped a little bit between themselves, the lions. They moved it around, they dragged it, and they finished that whole carcass, which is good. At least there's no waste. Everything's been eaten. It's incredible. So I wouldn't be surprised if the whole pride came here last night and fed. So now it's just a case of finding out which direction they've gone. I'm probably going to have a little walk around here soon and just see. Just check this, these thickets. The other thing is, what's that? No, nothing. The other thing is, after feeding on a buffalo like this, his lion's probably got quite thirsty. So they may have gone to a waterhole. But as we've seen with driving around, after all that rain that we had the other night, there are a lot of little mud wallows and pans that they can get water from. So they don't necessarily have to go to the big dams just to get water. They can get it anywhere. And then in these little drainage lines, there could possibly be little pools that have formed, and those lions will drink from that. But this is very interesting. I'm glad they finished this whole buffalo. So hopefully the cubs got to feed on it. I'm not too sure. So what I'm going to do, I'm just going to have a quick walk around here and see if we can get a direction which way these lions went. While I do that, let's see what Steph is doing on his walk this morning.
Sometimes when you're walking through the bush like we are at the moment, you find these game paths, these gigantic game paths. And this is one of those gigantic game paths that lead to Sydney's Dam and basically onto the crest of ground that lies between Vuyatelapan and Sydney's, the watershed, for lack of a better word. And it's just such an awesome place to walk. Not only is it quiet, but you have this expectation that you're going to be bumping into something almost at any time. Now, it's on this game path that we have that gigantic albizia tree that I think it's a false thorn. And it's there in the distance, and I want to go see if he's, or she, let's call it a he, I think he's big enough to be a he. Let's go see if he's put on his new summer suit and find out how fresh his leaves are, how he managed to weather this dry period. Of course, where we're standing at the moment is right on top of a big sandy crest. It's where Sandy Patch Road gets its name from. And there's not a lot of water in the sand, as you can see from this very grainy sand, that it doesn't hold a lot of moisture because the water just falls right through it. There's not a lot of clay in this sand, and so the water falls right through. Not a place that is a good thing for trees. Nevertheless, there's this giant albizia here. But there's just this feeling I have that I need to sort of keep my eyes open over here. It's one of those things that I've learned to, over the years, trust is this gut feeling that you get that something is here. There just has to be something here. Now, Jason, you've just asked me if I've been charged by a lion or a leopard on foot. Yes, I've been charged by a lion on foot a couple of times. I haven't been charged by a leopard on foot. I've been growled at many times by leopard in vehicles and on foot. I've been charged in a vehicle by a leopard, I don't know, maybe 30 or 40 times. I have a fond memory of a leopard we used to call Super M at Sabi Sabi. And so, excuse me not making eye contact as much as what I'd normally do. It's just, it just feels like something is here. I can hear something running in the distance. Sounds like some antelope there. So I have this fond memory of a cat we used to call Super M at Sabi Sabi, and he was a grumpy cat. He didn't enjoy vehicles at all, and if you stared at him for too long or pointed your finger at him, this cat used to just come bounding out of whatever bush it was on his back feet, big growl, waving his claws and his teeth around, and used to give everybody a big fright, sort of deep respect for leopard generated by that particular individual. And he used to charge us, if you make one small mistake, you come this much too close to him, or you point at him too much, or you've got too many cameras pointing at him at the same time, and he just used to have an absolute temper tantrum and come running at you. So I've been charged quite a few times by leopard, but not on foot. On foot they tend to run away from you or growl at you if they're on a kill that you can hear from quite a distance away, which makes it a bit easier to detect them. So Jason, yeah, I have been charged by them, not as often I suppose as what you'd think. Have a look at this beautiful little splash of colour here, Viam. That is a Commelina bengalensis, is the tree there, is that little flower. Or the blue common, just sticking his head out of all the grey. That's a wonderful flower. You're quite common in wetter areas, and I would imagine that it's growing here because of the fact that this particular tree managed to field some moisture and has allowed this commelina to bud. But just where are you going? There we go. There we go. Let me move some of these sticks out of your way so that you can get a good look at him. Just have a look at that. Now, this flower gets its genus name Commelina from the fact that there were some botanists that decided that they'd name this particular tree or this particular flower, and they were twins, the Comlin brothers. And you can see from the two petals, the two identical petals right at the top of the flower, that it depicts the two twins, the Comlin brothers, Commelina bengalensis. Just such a pretty flower out here. Locally used, if you squeeze this drop, you'll see there's a drop of fluid that comes out there onto my finger at the bottom. That drop of fluid is locally used to thicken porridge. It's a thickening agent. It's almost like you use cornstarch. Very effective thickening agent. Now, on that note, I'm going to send you over to Taylor, who's definitely got a surprise for you.
Before I tell you anything, turn your volume up as loud as it can go. Right, so we've got Inkanyeni, who's pacing around quarantine, who looks like an absolute monster of a leopard. He is really big. Isn't he such a beautiful cat? I can't believe that he's not even quite 4 years old just yet. Now, I don't know where Inkanyeni's cubs are. They apparently aren't around at the moment. And I suspect that she may be slightly upset with quarantine coming into her territory. We'll see. Apparently they were fighting a little bit earlier. It seems to have settled down slightly. We're going to sit here and watch the action unfold. This is absolutely incredible. You can see Nkanyeni at the back, just listening and watching. And she's going to try and keep her cubs away from him. And that's probably why she's going to act a little bit more on the aggressive side. But let's see what happens. I'm not going to try and depict the situation. I think we'll just watch it unfold. However, I must say, I am absolutely blown away at the size of this leopard. He is a lovely boy. He really is beautiful. Now, never did I think that we were going to find Quarantine and Nkanyeni. I was under the impression it was just Mr. Quarantine here. But my goodness, what an amazing surprise. Now I've got two leopards in one drive that I haven't seen yet, so my leopard count is getting quite good. Now I'm also not sure how old Nkanyeni's cubs are. I haven't seen them before, and this is the first time I'm seeing her, but she looks like a mature girl. She looks like she's at least older than about 10 years old, somewhere around there. But I'll need to get the exact birth dates, of course, and add them to my book. What, you heard me click my pen, I'm going to do exactly that. Now, like I said, these two leopards I've never seen before. And of course, you really get to learn a lot about them when you spend time with these animals. So I'd appreciate any information you have about either leopards that would help me understand what's probably going to happen here. You know, have they been sighted together before? Or is this the first time that we've ever really seen them encountering each other? You can see Quarantine, though, has put his head back down. He seems to be quite relaxed and not really too bothered by Nkanyeni. However, he is so big, he makes Nkanyeni look like a cub. The size difference is quite large, of course. I honestly didn't expect that Quarantine would be this size. I thought he would have been slightly smaller. And there they sit peacefully for the moment. Now, I'm not even sure who the mother of Nkanyeni is. Now, I think a couple of you are probably thinking what I'm thinking, or what I've said to you about how massive Quarantine is, and I know that Aqua is thinking exactly that. Now, I don't know when you last saw Quarantine. Like I said, I didn't expect him to be this big. I'm going to sit quietly again. Turn your volume up. She's growling. As she moves around, you can see how Quarantine sits up and watches very carefully. He's sort of lowering himself a little bit. The growls are just coming from Nkanyeni. Turning my radio off. I believe the last time you saw Quarantine was on the 10th of October, which is actually not too long ago. I like I said, I've never seen him. I can't believe how massive he is. Look at him. My goodness, the other boys in this area are going to have to watch out. He's definitely got youth on his side as well as his size. I think he's quite large for such a young leopard. He's only going to get bigger. In the next year or so, that dewlap is probably going to start to develop. And when he gets to about 6, well, he's really going to start entering the prime of his life, where he's going to think about challenging some of the resident males for their territories. I don't think Quarantine's got a particularly large territory. From what I've seen and what I've heard, I know he goes onto Nkoro quite a bit. Of course, Cheetah Plains. And I can only imagine occasionally the Torchwood as well, but maybe you could also help me with his territory span. And when he does become quite dominant, he's going to be able to challenge other male leopards and push them further away just to open up and expand his territory a little bit more. And that will only happen, though, as he gets older. Oh, wow, that's very interesting. Thank you, Judy H. Judy H. says that it is thought that Nkanyeni's cubs were sired by Shivambalana, which is, of course, Quarantine's older brother. Now, this is possibly why she's acting so aggressively towards him. It's because the leopards do want to mate, well, like any of the animals, they want to mate with the biggest and the strongest male leopard in the area, and perhaps he's just too young for the moment. He needs a couple more years to mature, and then possibly Nkanyeni will liken to him a little bit more. We've seen how flirty the females can be. She had a bit of a thorn stuck in her foot. Oh, goodness. Did you see how she just pulled that thorn out of her foot? What are you doing? Now she's chewing on it. Did you see that? It looked like she pulled it out and then she was... I don't know what she was doing there. It was quite bizarre, but at least she got whatever was in her foot is now out if it was causing her any sort of pain. I'm just adding Nkanyeni to my book before I forget. You can see something's bothering her there. There we go. Thanks very much, Kirsty. Sorry, I couldn't copy you the first time. So thank you, Karen. You've said that Nkanyeni was born in 2006. So she is indeed. She's 10 years old, or at least coming on to 10. That was a lucky guess on my behalf. And that she's the daughter of the beacon female. Now, I've never even heard of the beacon female, but we will put it in brackets, and perhaps she has a Facebook page that I can try and look a little bit more information of. That didn't make any sense. I think I'm so overwhelmed by the leopards being around us that I've forgotten how to speak English. Now, I'm hoping that while if we sit there for a little bit longer, we'll be able to see what Nkanyeni is going to do. Quarantine seems to have heard something in the distance that's caught his attention. Look at those beautiful markings on his back, though. He almost looks like a jaguar. Those beautiful big spots there going down his spine. Isn't that lovely? Ah, and apparently you have a name for this. You call that the landing strip. That is quite lovely. Quite unique as well. It's amazing how all these different animals have got their own little markings that make it easier for us to identify the different leopards, or any of the different animals, really. My goodness, thank you so much. You're all helping me out so much this morning. So, Chris, you've said that a key identifying feature on Quarantine is the pound sterling sort of spot pattern on top of his left eye. Now, hopefully he'll look towards us again and I'll be able to have a look at him and see that. But that's very important. That's a really nice one to know. Now, his pattern is quite beautiful. It reminds me of the spot pattern. You see how he's quite dark? Of a young leopardess down in the south. Her name was Hlawulani. And she very much reminded me of a jaguar, as does Quarantine's markings. He's a monster of a leopard. I can't believe how beautiful he is. Now, since we've arrived in the sighting, Quarantine doesn't seem to be bothered by the vehicles at all. And I know that a couple of you call him the poser. Thank you for that little comment, Ellen Fowler, who has let me know about that. And well, hopefully we'll be able to see why. some leopards, like I said, my favorite leopard, Lisbon, and of course this female I just told you about, Clarolini. Both of them very much loved the camera, and whenever there was an opportunity to pose on a marula tree or a termite mound or a fallen log, well, they jumped at that opportunity. Now, since we've been here, Quarantine hasn't really reacted much, other than really lowering his head slightly. But I haven't heard him growl back or sort of do anything along the lines to entertain Nkanyeni's bad moods. But I don't blame her. She's allowed to be a little bit on the feisty side when a young male leopard has come through, and she's probably got her cubs in the area. But we will see. She's settled down. She's grooming herself now. And Quarantine doesn't seem too bothered by her presence for the moment. It's just when she gets up and starts moving around. I know a couple of you in your minds are uncertain if this is indeed Quarantine. Does anybody know his spatten? That is Jamie's word that is now I'm starting to use. Another spoonerism, trying to get pattern and well, spot pattern out, and I said spatten. Maybe we should just make that an official word. But if you know his spot pattern, if you can maybe let me know and we can confirm. David, can we zoom into his face over there? Let's see, when he turns to us completely, I can see two very prominent spots. Look like there could be four there. One, two, three, four. Now, there's also a tiny little spot. Now, Ellen says it's a 3-3 spot pattern. Now, perhaps this isn't Quarantine. Maybe it's not. I've never seen Quarantine. He definitely doesn't have three spots on that side of his face. There's plenty more. There look to be maybe even five if you're going to count that little one little spot, but there's at least four. And that's what I thought. I thought he looked particularly big for a leopard that is coming on to 4 years old. But now I don't know who else this could be. Now, it doesn't look like a Tingana, because Tingana's got a massive dewlap, and this leopard is in fact lacking a dewlap. Well, there's a small one. I wonder who this could be. Well, the other guides are saying that it is Quarantine. Maybe I'll have to try and find some photos of Mr. Quarantine and then have a look. No, I can't. I have no service to try and do some stalking of the leopard, some investigating. We'll see. We'll just sit here and we'll just wait and see what happens. So we've got a couple of things we need to look out for when we do have a proper look at this male's face. We need to look for the sterling symbol above his left eye, and then we have to look for a big scar apparently that Quarantine has across his nose. Now, hopefully he does look up and we'll be able to have a look. The only thing with scars, though, something we all need to remember, is that scars do heal over time, and especially when they're young. They seem to heal much quicker than as they do when they get a little bit older. So I wonder also how long he's had that scar on his nose, or, you know, when that injury came through. We must remember that it's probably going to disappear over time, unless it was a really bad one. If you look at Tinyo, the male lion, the Birmingham, look how well his face is healed up after he split his lip. I mean, I think everybody initially thought that that was going to leave a massive scar, and it's not as bad. Let's see. Can you look this way once more, please? We'll just have to be patient. Now, we can only just see the right side of his face. Maybe what I'll do is I can... He's got such a nice open spot here. He does look like he's got a cut on his face, doesn't he? Hey, David, can you see that? Yeah. Can you all see that big scar on his right side of his face? Now, I wonder if that's perhaps... It doesn't look too old, actually, or from this distance. Let's see. Turn your head a little bit more so we can get a better look. Now, you can see why I say it doesn't look like there's three spots on his whiskers there. You've got the three very dark ones. But then right to the tip of his nose, he's got one more spot. Now, I would include that in his spot pattern. So I would say that he's got four spots on the right side of his face. But like I said, I think it's going to be one of those mornings again where we have this discussion as who possibly these leopards could be. Some of you have been watching the show for years and years, and you definitely have a better idea than what I do. I need to still learn the different individuals. Now he's up. Let's see where he's going to go. And I think we're going to try and keep up with him because I really want to try and figure out who on earth this leopard is. Let's go around. Just want to get a better view. Sorry, Kirsty, I can't really copy you at the moment, in case you're listening. That's quite interesting. I'm going to park over here. David, is that fine for you? What is she? She keeps... And Kanyeni's been quite interesting. She keeps chewing on sticks. I don't know if it's something that's stuck in her paw or if she's chewing it out of frustration. You can see whichever leopard this is, we decide that on who he is. He's moving away now, not even looking back at Nkanyeni. Okay, well, we've got to go back to our original spot. I want to keep up with him. I'm very interested now as to find out who this is. Like I was saying, is that we're going to have to do one of these mornings where we investigate and try and find out who exactly we've got here. It is one thing taking the advice of other people, of course, and who they think it is. But as we've seen with the young Ingrid Dam female versus Nchila drama, well, we can see how easy it is to get leopards confused. And of course, we don't want to do that. So I know you just have to bear with me for a couple of months longer until I actually see all the various leopards in this area. And then I'll be able to tell you a little bit better. It doesn't happen overnight, unfortunately. It doesn't matter how long you stare at a picture, but you need to sit and experience these leopards and sort of learn their behaviors and personalities as well, which can often help when it comes to identifying leopards. So I'm going to go a little bit further forward. Looks like, what are you chewing on? Because I do want to get a good view of his face. Are you eating a bone of some sort? Well, not quite eating it. I'm going to go around again. So he's large, but he's actually not that big. He's not as big as I thought he was. I think when he was laying down and all sort of bunched up, he looked slightly larger. I don't think he's particularly as large as Tingana. You can see in there, there's no dewlap. Hardly any, but we need to keep up with him. So we're going to make a little pathway through here. We're going to leave Nkanyeni, and I would really like to follow this big, beautiful boy here without getting a flat tire. So, well, we'll see. Oh, my goodness gracious. Right, I need to try and catch up with him as he's moving quite quickly. Let's go back across to Steph.
We managed to track down and reposition ourselves around this fantastic Albizia tree. This is the tree that I wanted to show you this morning, and just have a look at how splendid he is. Got his summer suit on, in actual fact got his spring suit on. This tree is flowering in profusion at the moment. It's the first time I've actually smelt a Albizia's flower, and it's quite a musty smell. It's not a sweet smell at all. It's a musty smell, for lack of a better word. I think it smells like a cupboard full of old socks. Just have a look at that. There's some of its flowers over there through the tree over there. You can see a white fuzz. The best is probably up there, yeah, against the sky there. We're just gonna try and show it to you. At the top of the tree, there's some old seed pods from last year and then some flowers. And it's being pollinated by day-flying moths, burnets. is what's pollinating these particular flowers. There are some bees around, but mostly it's just moths. Oh, a beautiful tree. Just an absolute giant, an old man here. Can't imagine how many hundreds of years old this tree is. And as you know, I always like to come and share some friendly moments with these trees. There's just a lot of things that are nice about old trees. Anyway, Taylor has repositioned now around quarantine, and just what an absolutely spectacular sighting. We'll catch up with you later.
Now, remember how I said just before I left you that I think it doesn't look as big of a leopard as he did when he was sitting down. He looked way more impressive. And I do actually, in fact, think that this is quarantine. He's definitely nowhere near the size of Tingana, and it would explain the behavior from Nkanyeni, with her not being sort of receptive of him, sort of acting a little bit more on the aggressive side. And it's bizarre, though, that they didn't count that one small spot on his face, and they've only given him a 3-3. Disappearing now. I'm not even sure if we can traverse over there. I suppose I should have a look. I think we're able to. We need to try and keep up with him. Okay, we're going to head into the bushes again. Nkanyeni's coming. Hang on. Oh my goodness, this is really interesting. Now she's following him. I wonder why. Now, there's two things that could be happening here. Like I said, I'm very uncertain as to how old Nkanyeni's cubs are. Maybe she's coming to Easter's game. Maybe this behavior that we're seeing is actually her wanting to say hello to quarantine. The fact now that she's following him. I thought if she was going to stay behind, that would have made a bit more sense. But now it seems as though the tables are turning a bit. She's following exactly the same route that he's walking, and we know that leopards like to do this. Often when the females are sort of trying to court the males, it's the opposite way when it comes to leopard. The ladies show the men when they are coming into estrus and she is ready to mate. But let's see, let's follow. This is very interesting. Yeah, picking up on his rolling in the scent. Oh my goodness, look at her leg. Can you see that? There's a lot of blood coming on her paw. Off her paw there. Now I wonder if this is not from all the thorns that were stuck on her leg, or maybe she's already got into a bit of a quarrel with quarantine. Do you see that? Oh no. Now it looks quite raw. There seems to be quite a bit of blood, but she was walking fine. She wasn't even limping. So it's definitely just a superficial wound. That's good to know. And often these cats, unfortunately, do succumb to these injuries. And when they bleed, sometimes it makes it look a lot worse. Maybe even if it was from one of the thorns or something that she got stuck on her legs. Often they have an anticoagulant in it, and it often increases the blood flow, which can make a wound look a little bit worse. But like I said, we didn't see her limping, so that's fantastic news for us. We didn't see that earlier as she was walking around. But I think she'll be fine. It's on her paw. It's easily accessible. She'll clean it and keep grooming it and keep it nice and clean. Now, leopards, you are being very interesting. So I'm happy, though, that I've come to the conclusion. I think it's quarantine. It does look like a youngish male. Now, I'm very uncertain about this behavior that we're sort of witnessing. Just before we arrived in the sighting, a couple of the guards did say that they were fighting. Excuse me. That they were having a bit of an argument. Now it's interesting to see. Now I can't see quarantine anymore. He's disappeared into a very thick silver cluster leaf forest, and with lots of marulas and fallen trees. We'll have to try and stick with Nkanyeni now, and hopefully she gets up and starts to follow him again. But I'm also going to reposition. Oh, I'm going to reposition very quickly. You can see she's trying to pull something out of her foot. I'm sorry, Kirsty, if you can copy me, I can't copy any of the questions you are sending through. Unfortunately, they're coming through a little bit dispersed. So I apologize if I don't... I keep missing vital keys, Kirsty, unfortunately. I apologize if I'm not answering any questions. It's just that the signal seems to be a little bit sort of up and down over here. But at least we've got a leopard. So we'll just continue watching her and see what she gets up to. We might actually be able to get a better view now of her foot. I've come a little bit closer. I was on the other side of the road. But let's see if we can have a closer look. She's a lovely leopard as well. She doesn't seem to mind the vehicles one bit. There you go, we can see that wound now. Yeah, that looks like it's from fighting. So perhaps, oh, here we go. You can see the blood oozing from that wound. That's very fresh. So I think I'm going to now that I can see this wound nicely, that's definitely from a fight. I think that, oh, it's oozing quite badly. But she'll keep licking it. You can see she's not limping at all. She's walking fine. So it can't be causing too much damage. And maybe she is trying to push quarantine out of her territory. We say it's just very difficult to tell the way that she's sort of following his scent right now. And she's tiny compared to him. I couldn't imagine what Nkanyeni must look like next to a leopard like the Anderson male. I reckon it would look like a mother and a cub from a distance. You can see she's staring into the distance. She's walking. Now we're going to have to keep up with her, so I'm going to carry on going. Here we go. Kirsty, I heard you this time. Fantastic. There was no interference. So, Angela and Brian, you're wondering, will male leopards kill rival cubs? Now, yes, they will. And that could explain as to why Nkanyeni is acting the way she is towards him. It will definitely explain why she's got that big gash on her leg, is while she's trying to maybe fend off quarantine. Though I don't think he would have been having a go at her cubs. He doesn't seem to be very interested in her at all. I mean, I think he's trying to just get away now and realize that, you know, oops, he's come into the wrong part of town and she's not standing for it. And maybe that's, like I said, maybe that's why she's following. She wants to push him right out and make sure that he knows that he is not welcome. With quarantine being so young, I wonder if he would go out and perhaps kill cubs at this age. Like I said, I still don't know how old Nkanyeni's cubs are. Someone's going to have to let me know. And that will also determine. Right. We're going to have one last look at this leopardess as she crosses in front of us. And we'll try and keep up with her. You can see that wound. Right. I think let's go across back to Juma and see how Byron is doing.
So I'm not doing very well at the moment. Hang on, there's some zebra at least. There we go. So I say we're not doing very well. But look at these two beautiful zebra. And why I say we're not doing so well is myself and Brian, or rather me, I've been hacking this morning. That's what we call it when you really just can't find anything. We had a good look around that area where we had that buffalo carcass. There were a lot of lion tracks in that area. Obviously, they finished the carcass. It looked like the whole pride had been there. But because of all the movement, and it was difficult to gauge which direction they moved out of there. Also, because it was so thick and it was basically surrounded by a deep drainage line, I assume they were possibly lying in there somewhere, but we just couldn't find any sign of them. So we eventually made our way out of there. Again, it was so hard to actually maneuver through that area. But it looks like our luck has changed a little bit. We've got some zebra over here. And then just look off to the left. Left-hand side of our vehicle, We've got some kudu, as well as a nyala moving through here. And you can see the kudu feeding. There was some nyala in the background, but look at these beautiful female kudu. So, Belinda has asked, is there a reason why some of the antelope in this area have got spiral horns and others have straight horns? So, Belinda, just quickly, I know you asked, your question was actually about the if they've got spiral antlers. So antelope, just quickly, antelope do not have antlers. They've got horns, and that's a young male kudu. Horns just starting to grow, and that's nyala at the background. That's an adult nyala. Look at that. Fantastic. Very dark gray. Stripes have faded slightly. They are still there, but they've got those beautiful horns which do spiral. So, Belinda, the spiral horns, and again, sorry, just getting back to why the antelope have horns, which grow throughout their lifetime. They do not shed them. They do not lose them. If they break, they are unable to grow back. Whereas deer have got antlers, and antlers are shed annually, and they grow back. We do not have deer in Africa at all, originally. Some have been introduced over the last few years, but we have got antelope in Africa, so they have horns. Now, why the reason why some have spiral horns and some don't, I'm not entirely sure. I think it's purely the way that they're genetically made up. It's not a case of one are better at using for protection than the others. It's just some antelope have got spiral horns. And it's actually interesting. These antelope, the nyala, the kudu, and the bushbuck, all form part of the same family of antelope, Tragelaphus, or Tragelaphus. It's the scientific name for this family. And one of the characteristics of this family is that they all have a spiral horn. They've all got a twist in the horn. So I don't think there's a reason why some have got straight, some have got curved or twisted horns. I think it's just the way they've made up. Usually the horns are there to basically attract females. Males will fight and use those horns to fight for dominance, and the bigger, stronger male will then win and attract the females. We'll be able to mate with those females. But also, the more impressive the horns, the better looking they are to the females. So that could also then cause them to be able to mate with the females. But some antelope do just have straight horns. The best example is the oryx. Now, we don't have them in this area. They predominantly found... Hang on, Steph's got something interesting that he wants to show you quickly.
All right, everybody, we've got a lion right here. She's just put her head down. No, she's still watching us. Okay, we're going to try and show you where she is. Okay, come this side. Straight across that fallen down tree there. She's just got her face in the shade though, so you're going to have to lift up your arms through this gap. All right. Let's see if we can get a bit closer to show you these lions. We've got some lions on foot, and lions on foot are always a tricky thing. They tend to run away from you, but what we're going to try and do is show you them and then call in Byron, who's been looking for these cats for most of the morning. So, okay, there she stood up now, through the gap there, and the male. About two females is what we've got there. You see her face? There we go. There we go. Alrighty, so we've got these lions on foot. We're not going to get any closer because it's going to make it very difficult to find them again. So within view of them, what we're going to do now is create some distance backwards so that they see us moving away. And then we're going to call Byron in, and hopefully he'll be able to show you these cats a little bit closer. Okay, let's back off. Back off, back to the terminal mound. They must just see us backing away. Here we go. All right, so now what we're gonna do is we're gonna call in Byron. If I can have a game drive radio. Thank you. All right.
One.
Oh, hang on. Radio speaking to me. I didn't quite know. I never use these things. Byron coming for Steph?
Go ahead, Steph.
We relocated these animals. They are between Albury's and Gallagher shortcut. Best approach would be from Albury's. Come down Albury's until I get you audio and then I'll direct you in.
Copy that. Steph will be there shortly. We'll be in that area shortly. Thank you. Well done.
All right, so Byron's on his way in. We're going to help him get into the sighting with the radio. And basically, we're just going to try and see where we are closest to. I think we're closest to Albury's here. The easiest would be Albury's, I think, to come in from the road there. And now, just to make sure that they are not going to move away too much, the bush is quite thick here, but we should be able to get a car in. And those lines were far enough away, they were about 100 yards away or so. And that's not close enough to chase these animals away.
I'm not too sure.
All right, and that's pretty much how you bump into lions. You hear them roaring, you walk into the area, they stick their head up, hopefully it's not too close to you, and then you call in a car. It's textbook, really. They didn't growl at us, they didn't run away from us. They watched us create some distance, and although the wind is blowing quite strongly in their general direction, let's just see exactly. This is an ash bag, yeah, you see it. Our scent is blowing almost directly onto them, which is probably why they stood up in the first place. It shouldn't be too bad for them. All right, so we're going to send you over to Taylor looking for those leopard. We're going to try and get Byron in here to show you those cats from closer by, and yeah, nice, see you later.
We're live. Oh, okay. We're trying to keep up with Nkanyeni, who's taking us on a roundabout of a day. She's now moving up and down, doing circles, coming back and forth. And it's quite interesting to navigate through here. Now, I can't see her at the moment. She went a little bit further away from me, so I'm just trying to go around. We could smell it. It smelled like something had died around here, too. And I wonder if perhaps that's what she's not picking up. Okay, well, we'll have to go over this one. Sorry, little dead tree. But we need to keep up with Nkanyeni. Where did she go? Quarantine has since moved out and on. Okay, I've got her again. I've just got to get up a little bit further. Ah, so it seems as though there's lots of gremlins around here. Is that every time Kirsty tells me a question, I only seem to get the last little bit of it. So I do apologize. We're going to get sight of her again. I just need to head up ahead. Thank you, Valerie. Just watch your head here. We're trying to get around and catch up to her. Valerie says that Nkanyeni's cubs were born in January 2016. Okay, so they... not too old, they're 10 months. Now, they would have to hide away, of course, if another big male other than Shavambalana came through here, because at that age, they still could run the risk of being killed. Obviously, though, at about 10 months, they're quite well equipped on their feet, and I reckon that they probably have a chance of running away. My goodness gracious, I need safety goggles. All the branches, you're right, David. David's gone pale from all the off-roading that we're doing. But we're going to catch up to her. She's now gone behind this termite mound, which we've only been around 16 times already. I'm just trying to keep up with her. I don't know what she's looking for. She hasn't given any contact calls. Let's go around the other side. So I don't know what she's after. This branch, we'll get there eventually. Please be around door number 5. There she is. And we've got her again. Just watch this little one. Thanks. Here we go, Davey. Can't lose my cameraman, of course. That would be terrible. Let's have a little view of her. And we'll try again to try and keep up with her. Now, I'm going to keep checking my phone because we're off-roading quite a bit and we're coming quite close to the Kruger boundary. So I don't want to go into the Kruger National Park. I don't think the rangers there would be very impressed with me. You can see her walking. She has her head quite low on the ground. She seems to be trying to pick up the scent of something. Now, it's strange. If it was her cub, she would just start contact calling. We're going to try and keep up with her. Right, so let's go this way around again. I don't know, maybe she's even trying to follow quarantine scent, but she's going the wrong way because I think he's actually gone straight into the Kruger. But like I said, we're not far from the boundary at all. Maybe even into Mala Mala, somewhere around here. Right. My goodness, girl, there are lots of trees to try and navigate through. Why are you taking us on this adventure? Oh, we have to squeeze through here, Darby. Are you ready? Here we go. Squeezing through. And every time I try and predict where she's going to pop out, well, I think she could maneuver even worse than Karula does. Darby, are you okay? Sorry, we've got some very pokey branches we're going to go through. Just can't. Right, we need to do this slowly. Watch your eyes. Okay, you ready? Now, we've got another interesting spot to navigate through. I think let's go back across to Byron and see if he's managed to get to those lions.
Right, so we're in this area, everyone, where Steph and Herbert have found the lions. Let's have a look. I'm just going to find out from Steph quickly where they are. Morning, Steph.
Hello, how are you?
Good.
Good.
Well done.
There's an old tea track on the corner here going to that big marula. Yeah.
You see
there. They're between the marula and us, just here somewhere.
Okay.
But our sense on them, so they might go that way.
All right.
But on the corner towards the marula, just not as far as the marula.
Okay.
And about maybe 60, 100 meters in.
Okay, great. I'll have a look.
Stand here waiting for you.
Okay, thank you. Good luck. Thanks. Well done. We've been hacking this morning. All right, great news. Let's see if we can find them, everyone. It's very, very exciting. I'm just going to reverse here quickly. Hold on. Don't see anything yet. Okay, like Steph said, his scent was blowing directly towards his lions, so that could cause them to move away. Let's look carefully. Okay. Taylor's still got the leopard, so while we're having a look here, why don't you get back to Taylor, see what the leopard's up to, and we'll give you an update shortly.
She's sitting at the base of this beautiful Balanites tree, and finally she's settled down, and I suppose it'll probably just be for a moment. She's seen something in the distance. But thank goodness, because she really tested us, and our maneuvering skills through some of that vegetation was quite tricky. But we did it. And now she seems very relaxed. Looking back, she sounds like she wants to call. She just did a little bit of a half sort of contact call. Maybe her cubs are somewhere around here. And of course she's up and on her way again. Where are you going to take us next, Nkanyeni? Please walk on that beautiful animal pathway that you can see. We would much enjoy that. At least we can sit here for a little bit and watch her as she disappears into the distance. Now that pathway, can you believe it, was made from the various animals that walk on here, probably most likely hippo and elephant and buffalo and all those big animals that sort of leave a wider pathway. Okay, we're going to have to get going again and keep up with her. Goodness gracious. Well, the northern Sabi sands leopards, well, it seems as though they don't give up too easily. Well, and they don't show themselves very easily, apparently, either. They like to keep us on our toes and moving. Maybe she's testing us. Maybe I'm going to get the approval from her and eventually she'll sit down for longer than 2 seconds. We might get another gap over here. Oh, hold on, David. It's very bumpy. Let's see if we can get... She's going behind some thickish vegetation again. She's just paused for a minute. She's just sniffing something again. Just watching it. It seems as though I thought she turned to come back towards us. She's going further and further into this block. Right, let's go around again. I don't think it's going to be too difficult to maneuver here just yet. It seems to be quite open. Let's go around another big termite mound. David, we're going to go under here. You good? This animal pathway is actually quite nice to move on, even for us. It's quite open. When I say that, and then it gets thick again, you can squeeze through here and through here. Now, where did you go, Nkanyeni? I like that name. I think there's such a nice ring to it. That's why I'm saying it all the time. Where are you? My goodness, she's far ahead of us, and she's changed position once again. She's going back sort of east. Thought she was going to come through north. Okay, we're going to have to take a gamble and go under all these trees. She's probably about almost 80 meters ahead of me. She's moving very quickly. Sorry, David. We've got a big aerial attached to Wendy, in case you're unsure as to why I've got to take it easy as we go through here. And it pokes up quite high. Well, I'm almost going to lose my eye. Got it? Sorry, I'm trying to man. My goodness, there's a lot of multitasking going on here. Put that under there so I don't lose my eye. Okay, David, she's gone down there. We need to find a gap now. I think we could have a gap coming up that we could maybe head along here for a little bit. No, right, let's see. So you're okay here, David? Sorry, Kirsty, I couldn't copy you there for a moment. Ah, okay. Well, perfect. Before the gremlins attack and I lose communication with the world, let's go back across to Steph and I'll try my best to keep up with Nkanyeni.
That's where Byron is right there. We're just standing in the bush trying to help him sort of triangulate his way into the sighting. He's probably about... 50 yards, sort of 60, 70 yards away from us. And looks like he's got them somewhere in there. It's so difficult to say where we're standing now. As you can see, the bush is quite thick. Are we nervous standing here? Yeah, absolutely. There's always this unease around lion. They tend to get quite nervous, and nervous things are dangerous things. You don't want to make anything nervous. But now that we've got, and we can see Byron inside there, and he's on the radio, looks like he may have found them or seen them in some thick bush. What we're going to do is make our way slowly backwards and out of this area. And what that'll do is it'll de-escalate these lions. Now, Lauren, you've asked me which animal would I not like to run into. Lauren, what's making me most nervous right now this week are buffalo. For some reason, this week is just buffalo are giving me the, as we call it, the heebie-jeebies at the moment. Every time I see one, I have this instant adrenaline surge. And it's because they are almost, it's right at the end of the season. The rain has fallen, but the grass isn't that good yet. These buffalo are in bad condition. They're being harassed by lion all the time, and they've got this edginess to them. So right now it's buffalo. Last week it was elephant. The week before it was elephant. Just also, once again, just lack of food, vast distances to travel to water, and then you go and throw like a stinky human like me into the mix. And it's just, there's just this tension in the air. But what I would say is that injured cats are probably one of the most dangerous. Anything injured. So I wouldn't like to walk into a lion with a broken leg or a leopard with a snare on it or something like that. But that is, you know, quite depressing news. On a very, very positive note, Byron has found these cats, so enjoy.
Yes, Steph, Brian and Byron have managed to find the lions that you saw. This is incredible. We've got the two females and a single male over here. We've been struggling this morning. Brian's having a good giggle at me. They've moved through the thickest bush ever to get a vehicle through, and but luckily, finally, we've got to see them, which is great. And I'm very happy we can show you. Just the two females and the single male. Don't see any sign of the rest of the pride. So they've possibly split up. Yesterday we saw the pride had split up and moved through different areas. And these are possibly some of the lions that did feed on that buffalo carcass that we found earlier. So from where we are, it's probably about 300 to 400 meters away. Maybe a little bit more, maybe half a kilometer, 500 meters or so. As the crow flies, that's where that buffalo carcass is, through this dense, thick bush. And they've moved off. It's interesting that they've moved into this area or this direction. There's not a lot of water around here, well, from what I can see. But again, you know, there are these little pans and little mud wallows that have formed because of the rain that we had. So they possibly got a drink last night or early this morning. And I think these are the lions that we heard calling earlier. We said we could hear them, but we just couldn't find out exactly where they were. That's one of the joys of having a team working together. It's nice having, you know, Taylor out and then also Steph on the walk. We're able to help each other a lot, and it was great that they were able to find these lions. It's not even 8 o'clock yet, and already it's getting very, very warm, and that's why these lions are resting in the shade now. Just want to update one of the other rangers who was interested in seeing lions. Just let them know where we are. Taxon for Byron. Morning, Dave. Dave, just an update. The pride that we've located, it's just the two females and a single coalition member at the moment. No sign of the rest of the pride. And one female is looking around. So actually, while we were driving through here, we saw some zebra wandering about, as well as some impala. And not too far, but in the thickets, I think if these lionesses are interested or they do walk around and bump into them, you never know. You know, we spoke about it yesterday, how opportunistic they are, and if they see potential food, they could easily hunt. I wonder where that female's moving off to, unless she's just going to look for some more shade. She was out in the sun a little bit. Dave for Byron. Dave, just an update. Located on two lionesses and a single coalition member. Just myself here at the moment, no sign of the rest of the pride, and we're just off Galago Shortcut, a few hundred meters south of the Biffleshook boundary or Biffleshook cut line. Copy. Just out of luck. If they start moving, then we're going to have to try and follow them again through this thick bush. It's so funny how occasionally some drives just really don't go your way, and I think I'm having one of those drives at the moment. I'm so glad we got to see these lions, but we have been struggling a little bit this morning. Not really finding any tracks and moving through thick bush, finding where the lions have been, but just missing them every time. Let's just see where they go and then I'll reposition the vehicle. Go ahead. Copy, thank you very much. See, again, these males, or this male is intent on staying very close to his female. Or at least one of them. And it's possibly one of the males. I'm sure it's one of the pairs we saw yesterday. We saw two, in fact. We saw one earlier in the morning, and then we found a different pair that afternoon. Yesterday afternoon. Okay, so they're starting to move. I'm going to try and get out of here quickly. Stay with us for a while. Let's see where these lions go. Just trying to work out exactly how I'm going to get out of here. Watch out, Brian. Some branches in the way. Here we go. It's been really funny driving with Brian again because the rest of the crew seem to get us, our names confused quite a lot, which is entertaining. So they call me Brian, they call Brian Byron. It is a little confusing if you're not used to it. We don't seem to struggle, eh, Brian?
No, not at all.
Okay, hold on. Almost out of here. There's that lioness and that male straight through the gap over there. Great, they're heading towards the road, everyone. So that'll make our lives a lot easier. But you can see how we're trying to maneuver and miss these trees and duck branches. I always say when animals do this, it's good for us. It keeps us humble. It makes us realize they're not tame. You know, they move wherever they want. And at times you just can't follow them, or find them for that matter. There we go, they're moving straight ahead of us now. Actually a lovely cool breeze at the moment, which is very pleasant, but the sun is baking down and the temperature is warm. It's just that breeze every now and then which makes it very pleasant. Oh, look, the male is doing the Fleming again, Fleming grimace. We've been speaking about it for the last 2 days actually, and especially yesterday we saw a lot of it. He's tasting the scent of the urine and he's putting that scent on that Jacobson's organ in the top of the palate. And that allows him to tell whether or not these females are in estrus. Have a look. See, and they do that snarl, what's known as the Fleming grimace. Very interesting behavior. And there they go. So everyone, they're actually moving into an even thicker area at the moment. I'm gonna stick on the road for now, and let's just see if we can work out exactly which direction they're going. Let me just reverse quickly. More trees behind us, but as you can see, it's impossible to get through there. There's, you know, the smaller trees and that we can kind of drive over so that they bounce back up so we don't damage them, but these big trees that have been pushed over and logs, that would just cause damage to the vehicle and we wouldn't be able to get through there anyway. I'm just having a look now. They are very thick in here, but they are skirting along. Excuse me, swallowed a fly. Okay, there might be a little gap that I can get through here. Hang on a second. All right, let me see if I can get another view of these lions for you. While I do that, let's quickly head back to Steph and see what he's up to on his walk.
What we're doing is we are basically moving. The lions that we found now, that male and female, we're lying a little bit further north of where we heard the roar come from this morning. And although cats do move, as you saw them move right now into some thick bush, the rest of the pride seems to be somewhere in this bush in front of us here. So we've decided to come walking through here. It's very difficult to drive a car through here. We haven't got any tracks to follow, but what we are doing is we're just trying to edge our way through this drainage line and looking for shady spots, spots where we most likely are to find the rest of this pride. So that's basically what we're doing at the moment. We're sort of ambling through the bush, having a bit of a chat, mainly about how scary it is to bump into lions that are angry with you. It's sort of the the de-stress from finding lions on foot is always talking about scary moments that you've had. That particular lion sighting was textbook. Like I said, the fact that we could see them from far away, we could get a car in there, they hadn't moved at all, was just phenomenal. And obviously what we thought was two lioness right in the word go happened to just be a male and a female. We just couldn't see the mane on the male. We were standing a bit far away, or I just misidentified it, which is also a very big possibility. Do we think that that's the case? Many gardenias are going to flower. This is obviously a low-felt gardenia tree, and in it is a velvet spider's nest with a spider there eating a beetle of some sort. Now, I actually don't think that that's a velvet spider. I think that that's a spider that's living in the velvet spider's web. And the reason I'm saying that is because it's not being joined by any of its friends. Oh, there is another spider there. Sorry. So that is a velvet spider or a community nest spider. There's another spider directly behind it. They've immobilized that beetle and are now feeding on it. They cooperatively hunt together or build these webs together, and that allows them to catch far larger prey, which they then share amongst one another, incorporating the dead husks or the rubbish into the nest, thereby enlarging it. But these trees that this velvet spider has built its nest in, or these velvet spiders I should say, has a beautiful white flower that when pollinated by moths becomes yellow. So it changes from white to yellow once it's pollinated and has the most wonderful smell. Gardenias have got the most beautiful perfume out here. I can't wait to see when they start to flower. They'll start to flower probably in the next couple of weeks or so. I don't see any buds at the moment, so we will move on until we do find one. And carry on with our search. Basically, I can see something there. That is an elephant. There we go. I tell you, he's scary as today. Luckily, the wind is blowing in our direction. And while we make our way around that elephant, we will send you over to Byron.
These lions seem to be making it a bit easier for us. Look at this lioness, she's walking quite close. That's wonderful. Well, that's made my morning a lot better, because we've had a tough morning finding them, but to have this lioness walk so close to us, what an experience. See the males just lying off to the distance in the shade over there. At least they've come out into the open again, so, and they're walking along the road now, which is good. Let's follow them a little bit. Not sure where they're heading to, unless they're heading back towards a waterhole somewhere. I'm surprised that they are still moving around. There we go, found some more shade. They're laying down again. I'm gonna stay with them for a little bit, just see which direction they go to, or if they do head towards one of the pans or waterholes. While I do that, Steph has got a small creepy crawly he'd like to show you.
You know, distracted by walking away from that elephant, and we're actually still well within the danger zone here, but I couldn't help but show you this caterpillar that's busy eating this bushman's grape. And for the life of me, I don't know what caterpillar this is. I've bought myself a book on caterpillars and moths, and so far every caterpillar that I've found has been misrepresented in this book. I don't quite know what it is. But interesting nonetheless, those hairs that it has on its body are there for defense. They're very irritating, and so that worm will thrash about if it got caught by a bird, and the worms or the caterpillar's strategy is to get one of those irritating hairs lodged in the throat or in the eye of their potential predator, so a would-be bird. And the colors on it are just fantastic. I mean, have a look at where its legs are, just the patterns. It's just really, I don't know, I just find caterpillars and butterflies to have some of the most beautiful colors on them. And very similar to fish, they tend to have colors that would otherwise be, I suppose, clashing, you could say, but they form such a nice mix with one another. I mean, you can imagine having a couch, I wouldn't say, what did I say? I said patterned like that, I wouldn't say covered in. The worm, let's see, there's his 4-6 feet in the front with claws on. You can see there he's just exuded from his mouth parts a droplet of fluid that he was feeding on. You probably find that this bushman's grape is allowing this caterpillar to have some or other type of chemical defense. That drop of fluid is probably very bitter or doesn't taste nice at all, and would be in this posture and exude at the lightest touch, exude that droplet in an effort to dissuade a would-be predator. Just have a look at that. Now, caterpillars can synthesize some quite dangerous compounds, so I'm not going to be tasting that particular droplet of fluid. I have no doubt it would taste horrendous. But we'll leave it alone. You can poison yourself out here with caterpillars, I must be honest with you. But anyway, that's what he's drinking. Look here, it's going to drop off the edge there. Leroy, you've just asked me, can you ever tell what color the butterfly might be from its caterpillar? Leroy, generally no, to be quite honest with you. What I am going to do is show you my butterfly book that I bought, because in this particular instance, this is a much better use for it, is to show you how different caterpillars can be from their adult form. Now, in this particular, let me put it up here by the tree. Have a look at the guinea fowl butterfly, which is a fairly common butterfly that we find here. Have a look at its caterpillar. Absolutely different to what the adult looks like. Here, the pearl-spotted Caraxes, another dark green camouflaged caterpillar with a horned head. Also very, very different from the adult butterfly. Then you get some that are quite similar. You get this particular window acria. It's another common butterfly that we find here. Have a look at that bizarre hair-like projections on the caterpillar. And then even more weirdly are these ones here, like the foxy Caraxes, which is also another very common... very common butterfly. Have a look at that bizarre caterpillar with that huge helmet of hair, or helmeted head, I should say. Wait. Oh, okay, sorry, we've got a scrub here. They are very well known as being the heart attack makers of the bush. Excuse me for that reaction. That, we have that elephant close by, and I actually thought that elephant had snuck up on us, so that was hares and rabbits out here, I tell you, giving me the heebie-jeebies. All right, let's carry on with our display. Ooh, just catch my breath over there again. Have a look at this one, the African leopard, another very, very common butterfly that we have over here. Very different to its caterpillar. So, I mean, I'd like to say that no, the caterpillars are different to their butterflies. I mean, there are, I suppose, some similarities in the end, but no, generally the caterpillar is very different to the butterfly at the end of the day. This guy here on this leaf is still busy vomiting up his fluid. Fantastic. And I hear Taylor has got another caterpillar. She is a source of amazing things, isn't she?
So this little creepy crawly was crawling on David's foot, and it looks to be just a younger version of the caterpillar that we had earlier with the community nest spiders. Now I'm still a little bit uncertain as to what it is. Now, straight off the bat, the green ones that we tend to see around here, it could possibly be a lunar moth larvae. However, I'm not 100% certain. This does have a few hairs, but I think that there's a couple of darker specks on a lunar moth larvae. Maybe, what about what eats marula leaves? Let's see if there's any larvae perhaps that eat marula leaves. But this one is very quick, very feisty, and moving away and off my notebook. Don't come back to us. Look how quick it goes. That's very impressive. Now, I wonder if it's because you're getting hot in the sun. Okay, I think I'm going to put it out now. Let me quickly unplug myself. Come, little caterpillar. Don't go in my book because you're going to get squashed. Let's release it. Now, I don't know what it eats, but we can just put it on this sickle bush. Well, and then I'm sure it will find its way around. Where do we go? We need to come up here. Yes, go onto the stick. Doesn't want to go onto the stick. Maybe it needs some encouragement. There we go. and it quickly is wiggling away. Oh, I'm moving the branch. Somebody just flew past my head. Well, and I think that that's a better spot then to keep that caterpillar. We will let it go. And like I said, I'm sure you've taken quite a few screenshots for me so I can have a little look when I get back. And we can try and identify this caterpillar, which will be quite exciting. Right, I'm back and plugged in again. Now, any insects? There probably are. I'm not sure of any just off of the top of my head. I'll have to have a look when we get back. But I'm pretty sure I've seen something about, I don't know why I'm thinking of an ant and caterpillars sort of working together. Maybe not in sort of a parasitic form, maybe more in a symbiosis. But I'm sure that there'll be something that does parasitize the larvae, whether it's some wasp, like we get the spider hunting wasp that goes after big spiders, of course, and then it will sting either the spider, but like do it with perhaps caterpillars and take them down to their burrows, lay their caterpillar and use it as a life host for their larvae. So there's definitely a possibility. Some exact ones I'm not sure, and what I'll have to do is I'll have to have a look and see types of caterpillars we get in this area and find if there are any specific parasites that only go for a certain caterpillar's larvae. I'll have to have a little look at that. Now we're going to be leaving Cheetah Plains. We're coming up to the big paddock, which is of course the helicopter landing pad. So don't worry, there's no domestic animals here. You can see fast. And I'm going to lose you, unfortunately. So before I do, let's very quickly go back to Steph.
We're still busy, patrolling the haunts of these cats where we know they've been for the last couple of months. And one of the best places to look is on the edge of these quite thickly wooded drainage lines. And although relatively dangerous to stick your face into in case something is lying in the shadows, it's not such a bad idea. Ah, come and have a look here, Via. There's a giant robber fly here. I'm gonna try and point him out with my shadow. Let's see, I'm gonna see. Finger. That is a giant robber fly. They snipe mainly grasshoppers. So as a grasshopper flies overhead, this fly flies up from the bottom of the ground, catches it in this basket of feet that it has. Ah, hang on, see, he's going now there. It's going to the end of my finger. There he is there. They catch grasshoppers. They take that
Now we made it out of the treacherous dip which the gremlins love to hop onto the vehicles to. Well, we're slowly making our way back towards Juma, and I thought what we could possibly try and do, and I think David is quite excited, is maybe go back to that buffalo carcass that we went to last night, that we've been sort of following over the last couple of days, and see what's happening. Maybe those vultures have come down in groups now. They've had the entire night to plot their plan as to what they'd like to do. I think that would be a good idea. And sorry, I forgot to mention that Nkanyeni slipped out of my sort of reach and we lost her. I couldn't see her anymore, but as we were driving along, I did see quite a few vehicles just on the Mala Mala boundary, and I presume that is where quarantine ended up. He moved straight through that very thick block and went straight over there. And I wonder if maybe, I'm very confused about that entire situation, because she was severely battered and bruised. I mean, she had a cut on her left shoulder, she had the gash on her paw, and whether it was an argument, whether she was quite interested in quarantine, I'm not certain. It was very interesting in behavior. And the fact that she was going up and down looking and smelling for something, I don't know if she was looking for her cubs, because she would have done a little bit more contact calling then. So perhaps try and push him further out. Oh, thank you so much to James, who's informed me on the meaning of inkanyeni. It means light, which is quite the light, which is quite nice. I'm going to add that down. I'm unfortunately not well equipped to the Shangaan language like Mr. James Hendry is, so it's quite nice to learn all these different words. I learned it up here a little bit, but not very well, sort of a funny galore version of it. I wish I could speak it fluently, but I cannot. Now, we've got a little bit of a way to go before we get to Cheetah Cutline. But I think let's go back across to Byron while I venture on towards the vultures.
So we've lost those lions, everyone. They've moved through a dense thicket again, and I think possibly going to head down towards a drainage line just to settle down for the day. Maybe find some water in there that they can drink. Although they did move past the little puddle and they didn't drink it, so probably not too thirsty. It was great to see them. I'm glad we got to find them eventually. Just the male and the two females. Not too sure where the rest of the pride is, and they haven't been seen yet this morning. But I'm sure they also hiding in a drainage line somewhere. Oh, watch his impala. Sorry, just a quick glimpse of them. What, here comes another one across the road. Oh, hang on. Let me just see. There's some others off to the right. Let's just see if I back up. Maybe they head across the road too, and we get them jumping. It's wonderful to see these impala. Here they come. Look at this. Here comes a few more. Hang on. A few more coming. Here comes a big male or ram. Jump for us. Come on. Wow, it's amazing. amazing to watch them run. Yeah, there's the last one coming. Come on. One last jump. not really. Wow, there's actually a lot of impala coming through here. Keep having a look at the road, everyone. Lovely big herd, probably looking for a bit of shade and maybe even some water a little bit later. Come on. No really big jumps, but wonderful to see them just prancing across the road. Wow, there we go. Wow, look at that. Wonderful, wonderful big jump. Well, that was great. Lovely to see them, Paula. So as I was saying, those lions probably moved off into a thick area now, down into a drainage line, and probably going to rest there for the rest of the day. And I know I would do the same. It really is getting much warmer now. It's about 80 degrees Fahrenheit, 81 degrees Fahrenheit, very, very warm. Okay, we're gonna drive around and see what else we can find. While I do that, Steph's got some large birds he wants to show you.
You know, it's not every day that we get to see a bunch of vultures come out in the morning and catch the first thermals of the morning, and that's exactly what we're watching there. We're watching a column of vultures that has found a thermal this early in the morning, one of the very first thermals, and are now circling inside that rising column of hot air. You'll notice that without flapping a wing, they will gradually decrease in size as their height increases. And all the vultures in this particular area would have seen their friends in those thermals, will rise up with the thermal, and then using their exceptional eyesight, will see another thermal. They see it by rising pieces of grass and dust and changes in air density. They can actually see it, very similar to how we see variations in air above a hot pot of water or above a kettle or above a fire. Vultures can actually see those density changes. And there they tight in that column. You can see all spinning clockwise, and that is because in the southern hemisphere, winds turn clockwise around a low pressure. So low pressure is a rising body of air, hot air. They are spinning clockwise, and that is to make use of the corkscrew function of rising air around a low pressure. That is just absolutely fantastic. You'll see as the power of the thermal decreases, they will start spinning in some other directions, and also vultures will leave the thermal. And that's exactly what's happening. So they've reached the top of the thermal, and now vultures are leaving and flying to find other thermals. Isn't that an absolutely wonderful thing to see today? Really, really, really is. I think we're so privileged to actually witness that. It's not every day that you get to see them. Another thing that we are privileged to see is this. This is what's left over from a gigantic buffalo thorn tree. Yes, you heard me. This is a buffalo thorn tree. Here's the evidence, the hook and the straight thorn with the three prominent veins on the leaf. Here we go. You can see me show you a baby leaf here. There you go. That is a very typical buffalo thorn leaf. And this has to be the biggest buffalo thorn tree at Juma. I would imagine, I know of one other tree that's nearly this size, but not one that has this girth. It's still living, it's still quite tall. And as VM quite rightly put it, not even a tree this size could escape the attention of the elephant. Shame. But it's still growing. I'm having one of his leaves for breakfast. Still tastes quite good. New buffalo thorn leaves are very tasty and quite high in protein. And funnily enough, and for reasons unknown to me, generate a serotonin increase in my body. So it's almost like a happy leaf. Antidepressant, a natural antidepressant, and that they taste quite good. Oh, this is a big tree. I do see that this tree has got some damage from borer beetles in the top here, so it might even be storm damaged rather than elephant damage, to be quite honest. And you know, rightly so, this tree is ancient. In terms of buffalo thorn trees, this tree would be the great granddaddy of all the buffalo thorns here in this area. Just nice to spend time with these guys, you know. Once again, just the majesty of fairly large trees is quite astounding to me. And now we're on top of this big termite mound, and the reason why I'm on top of this big termite mound, oh look, the vultures are above us now. Awesome. Lots behind us here, VM. Yeah. And they're being attacked. Excuse me. The buffalo thorn taking retribution on my esophagus. Have a look, there's a Wahlberg's eagle getting attacked by some drongos. There we go. Also, just looking to get some height. Don't quite know what to show you at the moment. There's just so much happening. Oh, this is just such a wonderful sight. And you look up into this clear blue sky and it's just filled with these majestic birds. And they're fairly close by. Usually by the end of the day, it's so difficult to see them because they're so high up. But this is allowing us to have such a nice view. Can you see the same thing I'm seeing, Vim? Over there. There, the collection. Sorry about that. We just needed to double check that what you are seeing is the same as I am seeing. Vim has his eye glued to a little screen and of course can't see the whole sky like I am. But what you're looking at there is exactly what I'm talking about. Just these collection of vultures. Obviously of note is the fact that vultures are on steep decline in wilderness areas around the world. Sadly in South Africa, they are used in traditional medicine and the trade in parts from these vultures has increased drastically over the years, and I must say it's having a very dramatic effect on vulture numbers. So quite sad about that. But on a happier note, Byron has also found a bird that he'd like to show you.
Listen to this beautiful bird call, everybody. Just listen. Wonderful. This is a black-headed oriole. Look at that beautiful red beak and that very dark black head and that yellow body. Amazing. Very beautiful, beautiful bird. The black-headed oriole and an incredible call. We hear them constantly around here. Sometimes tricky to see. Oh, it's such a lovely sound. It seems very happy calling up in the tree there. Possibly a bit of a territorial call. Maybe trying to attract a mate. I love seeing birds out in the bush and to be able to show them to you if they do sit still, because often they, you know, you get to see them and they fly away very quickly and it's difficult to keep up with them. So to have an oriole in the tree like this sitting calling for us is really wonderful and really special. Such a wonderful call. All right, we haven't had anything else walk past us just yet. A lot of impala around at the moment, which is wonderful. So there are a lot of impala around us, been moving through into thicker areas. I think we did see some come from a waterhole, so possibly moving into the shade of the trees, going to start feeding for the day. But I haven't seen too much else around. Still a few birds calling, like this oriole. Taylor's keeping up her tradition, I think, of finding dead buffalo. Let's see what she's got this time.
I'm going to keep checking on it every single day until there is absolutely nothing left. Now, I'm sure you saw that vulture around there, and well, it sounds a bit muffled because I'm hiding from the stench with my towel, but let's go back to the buffalo. It's very stinky. It is not a pleasant smell at all, and the wind is swirling, so sometimes it's okay. Well, then, and then when you least expect it, you get a mouthful of buffalo carcass. Now, there are quite a few vultures around here, and I'm sure that they're going to start coming down to feed. You can see there's some feces on that buffalo. So it seems as though the vultures have been there, but I don't know where they're eating from. They haven't opened it up, so they must be starting to eat this carcass from the rump. You can see that they haven't opened the stomach up just yet, which is unusual. I thought that those white-backed vultures would have torn through the flesh. And you can see, though, that the maggots are rotting the carcass almost completely. All the maggots on the feet and around the edge of the buffalo where it touches the ground. And I'm actually enjoying coming and over and visiting this buffalo sort of at least every day, just to have a look and see how the whole process sort of turns out. Remember, we found him when he was unfortunately still alive with an injury and he bled out. And then we came back and the maggots had started to feed on him. And then we've had a couple of vultures showing some interest. There's a couple flying overhead again. Now, I parked much further away than what I did yesterday. I'm probably about 50 meters or so away from this carcass, hoping that by giving them enough room, the vultures will come back down. Though when we came through, there were just a couple scattered on the ground. They weren't actually on the carcass itself. And there are quite a few in the distance. I don't think we can see them now that we're on the trees. But it'll be interesting to see if they eventually open it up and take care of the entire thing. And where are those hyenas? Where are the jackals? It's a perfect meal for them. And of course, it's getting very hot again this morning. I think we're going to have a super hot day, possibly hotter than what it is than what it was yesterday. Right, I've removed my my mask now, as the smell is not too bad just yet. Now, Green Eyes, you're wondering, is there high humidity today? At the moment, it is quite humid indeed. I'm not sure exactly on the percentage. It's probably around maybe 30 or 40% humidity. Not too bad, but as the day progresses, and of course, as we sit and wait for the clouds to start building up in anticipation for the next set of rains, well, then it's going to get hotter and hotter until we have those rains to cool down the earth again. But it seems as though the vultures are not playing ball and they don't want to come down. So I think we're going to try and make our way out of this little area over here. But let's go back across to Byron, who has a waterbuck.
And there are indeed waterbuck, Taylor. Look at this, a different antelope that we haven't seen this morning yet. They've got this beautiful white ring around the rump. Makes it very easy to identify them. It's a young male at the back. You can see those small horns. Those horns will get a lot longer and they'll curve slightly. It's a female. They've got very shaggy coats. It's interesting. They look almost like deer, but they are indeed antelope. There's the other one. And interesting thing with the waterbuck. So they get the name waterbuck because they are very reliant on water. So they do need a lot of water and they do drink a lot of water and they are often found around water. But they've got an interesting defense mechanism against predators. So they actually secrete a lot of oil onto their skin and into their coat. And what happens is, because they're always around water, if they are chased by any predators, a lot of the time the waterbuck will choose to run into the actual waterhole or the dam to get away from the predator. And because of that very oily skin and oily coat, it allows the water to drain off a lot quicker and not soak in and bog them down. So they've got a very interesting defense mechanism, and it seems to be working, or it seems to work quite well. But of course they will still move around and feed during the day, but they'll most definitely go to some water at a later stage. That's lovely. So nice to see them. You see that very, very prominent white ring around the rump. Very interesting to see those white markings on the body. Let's see what else we can find. Some impala walking around with those waterbuck. as I mentioned, we've seen a lot of impala around, which is good because impala is a good food source for a lot of predators. So chances of more predators coming into the area are good. Leopards especially, leopard and cheetah, and impala is a perfect size prey for those animals. The lions seem to be very happy with buffalo. They've been hunting buffalo every day for the past little while. And speaking of buffalo, right ahead, here we are. A small herd of buffalo, and off to our left, two. A few of them around. Herds like this are predominantly females and younger buffalo. There will be big males within the herd, but a lot more females and youngsters. And we've been commenting over the last few days how we can see a bit of green grass shooting up at the moment, and that's what these buffalo are feeding on. We were very lucky to have fairly decent rain the other night. We do need a lot more, and we do need some storms coming through. But because of that little bit of rain, I think it's ignited this little growth, this growth spurt of green grass. So a lot of animals are moving back into the area that are herbivores, like the buffalo, zebra, as we saw earlier this morning. We saw a group of wildebeest much earlier while Taylor was with the leopard. So a lot more wildebeest coming through too. All those species feed on this grass. And just hear these buffalo moving through the trees, the branches breaking. Can you hear that? They're all around us. Well, it was a tough morning for Brian and myself, but we had fun and eventually got to see some lions. I hope you've all enjoyed it with us. Thank you very much. Brian, thank you very much. And thanks to the thumb, we are going to cross back to Steph and just see what he's up to and say goodbye. We'll see you this afternoon on our sunset safari. Goodbye, everybody.
We are slowly trying to weave our way through the thickets and the forests here on our way back to camp for breakfast. We've finally managed to come through this bush. It took a little bit of tiptoeing. I must be honest with you, some quite tense, quiet moments here in this group. But it's come to that part of the day where we would like to say thank you and goodbye. From myself and VM and Herbie, we want to say thank you very much for your support. Thanks for all your questions as always, and we'll catch you again soon.
So we've stumbled across a group of elephants and this beautiful elephant bull, who they can see they've had a mud bath. Now, I've just arrived at Hyena Road, and what I really want to do is I want to check on these magpie shrike chicks. We haven't come to them for a few days. Let's quickly have a look at them. I know the elephants were just there. We're going to see one more cross the road, but wouldn't it be nice to see how Mr. and Mrs. Magpie Shrike are doing? Oh, well, we seem to be surrounded by elephants at the moment, and it doesn't look like the magpie shrike is on her nest at the moment. We'll just stop here. You can see to the top right of that elephant in the Tamboti tree, there is a nest. But it doesn't look like anybody is home just yet. And I suspect that's probably because of the elephants moving around here. Maybe they've chased her off, or Mom and Dad could be out looking for something to eat too. Remember, Mom and Dad are both going to be working now to try and feed all those chicks as these elephants casually move past into the thicket. Now maybe we can catch them again. We'll have to come and check up on Mr. and Mrs. Magpie Shrike perhaps this afternoon. And there's even a giraffe for you to look at. Look at this. It is all happening. Is that fine, David? It is honestly all happening here this morning on Hyena Road. We've got elephants, we've got vultures flying over, we've got this beautiful giraffe, of course. might be an opportunity for you to get an elephant and a giraffe in the same picture. Let's see this youngster's behavior. Look how it's raising its head. Not too keen on the giraffe, of course, but they're living in harmony. And you can see the giraffe, this lovely girl, watching carefully to make sure that the elephants don't get any ideas, but they're not particularly worried with them. Now there's another little pool of water. I wonder if these elephants are going to have a... Oh, I just shocked myself. Yes, I think so. Let me go forward for you, David. It seems as though I'm going to go back. I'm going to get one last look at these elephants splashing in the water. Now I just need to go backwards. We'll reverse like lightning. Oh my goodness, will we make it in the final minute? No, it seems like those elephants are not splashing for too long. Perhaps they had a wallow further up on Hyena Road. We know that there are quite a few of them that are filled with water at the moment. And I suspect that we're going to see the elephants doing quite a bit of playing around in the water today. Bye-bye, guys. I hope you have a wonderful morning. And you can see them now disappearing off into the thicker vegetation now that they've had a drink. They're going to go off and have something to eat. Now, unfortunately, we're down to the final seconds of the show, and I'm going to have to say goodbye to you, but I hope that you've enjoyed it, and I just want to say a big thank you to Steph, a big thank you to Byron, and all the ladies in Final Control, and we shall see you again this afternoon for a wonderfully hot sunset safari.